class from the handbook, but you've got something from...
Yeah, that is correct. It is a fan homebrewed class. I found it on the... I found it on a D&D 5e homebrew website that I can probably find the link to and toss it in the chat if anyone wants me to. It's got a whole lot of stuff on there.
Sure, awesome. And Rachel, when she's back, will be playing Mara the Barbarian, who is big and hairy and scary. That's all I remember.
Sounds about right.
It's been a few weeks. And I am playing Stretic, the wizard necromancer. He's an old dude who's stitched together from the different parts of people he's experimented upon. Therefore, he's got a bunch of different hands. He's got kind of grafted on skin from different parts. And he has a whole lot of different parts where they potentially shouldn't be.
Who knows how many tongues there are?
No one can tell. And you don't even know where they'll be. So, but somewhere they're in there, salivating. What's up, Trey? How's it going? How's it going, Lucille? So, David, we should do a catch-up on what's been going down previously.
So, this is actually just session 2.
It is.
So... it's a little bit interesting, really, because the whole thing got a little bit skewed by donations, but we will cover that in a minute. So basically what happened was the characters woke up in the jail cell, and they realized quite quickly that they'd all been dragged from different, possibly different continents, or at a minimum, but more likely different worlds.
Yeah.
So it turns out that the world that they're on, where the Emerald Citadel is located, they don't have... or from what you've gathered from speaking to one of the characters, they don't have children as such. Mm. The population is effectively barren, so they can't have children. So what they do in order to maintain the population of the world, they kidnap into slavery people from various worlds. So they send out sort of hunting parties through portals to capture people, and then they sell them in the Emerald Citadel to slavery.
That's right.
Now, that was the destination. That was was planned to happen to the characters. So they were they woke up in a jail cell. They introduced themselves to each other, and then a wild magic roll from a donation. I can't remember exactly who donated, but a wild magic roll altered the physics of the area so that the stonework, that the iron bars that held them, and Rachel's character being a barbarian, they tried to force these bars several times to break free. The iron bars, the stone that the iron bars were set into, turned to stick his play, causing the bars to fall down while they were being, interviewed or assessed by one of the slave masters who was in an auction.
Yeah.
And then, so quickly after that, they killed the slave master, and they were basically spent a little bit of time in this jail cell just trying to decide what to do next. There was the sort of jail keeper, a guy called Rich, who was this like balding, sort of fat, sort of slave.
Yeah, he was a real dick.
Yeah.
That guy.
And he gave the players a little bit of information about the background to the world, and the fact that the way it works is that the slaves would normally have a magical tattoo placed upon them that would cause them to die if it wasn't renewed every week for the people who are were in the bronze class or caste. And then there's obviously slaves in the silver caste where it lasts a bit longer, and then the upper tier of the slaves is the gold caste. And then this whole Emerald Citadel is founded on this this sort of culture. But the Emerald Citadel itself is in this world, which is an ancient world, and a lot of the money and the wealth of this world is actually obtained by going out into the jungles and looking into this a longer, older, lost civilization.
All right.
In the jungle, so people would be sent out effectively to pillage tombs, etc., to get revenue.
Pillage the village.
Now, Rick was kind enough to provide a little bit of information under duress, and once he realized his own situation required the help of the players to survive, he mentioned that there was a place called the Free City, which was about 5 days' journey by boat upriver. Now, if the players could make it to the Free City and find a sponsor there, then they wouldn't be sort of reconnected as slaves. And that's where the players were heading. They were on a boat. They'd had one day on the river already, and the boat was slowly sailing its way up towards the Free City.
Nice. So that's where we're at, folks. We're on a boat going to the Free City, trying to get fucked by all the slave dudes, because we're on a different world, and we will probably die along the way. But a few ways you can interact with our show. We're already halfway to our follower goal today. We already had 10 followers today, which is awesome. So at 20 followers, you guys are going to decide what happens next in our game. So if you haven't followed, hit that follow button and join us when we get 20. We're going to throw your ideas into the chat as to what could happen next in the story, and the most popular decision which comes out of our straw poll will actually affect our game. What's up, Xavier? How's it going, dude? Also, we hit 20 retweets. The same thing will happen. We go check the retweets, see where we're at already. Already looking strong at 10, so halfway on that one already. And also, we hit 3 subscribers. You can hop up in our little sub tub and get the cool emotes and stuff like that. Then we'll have another one as well. So you can also affect our game via donations, give players nat 1s, nat 20s, wild magic surges, all that sort of good nonsense. Support the show and keep us doing what we're doing. So other than that, I think we'll be ready. Once again, Rachel will be here in about 20 minutes, you reckon now? 10 or 20 minutes now. So she'll be here in a little bit. And Skaggeth is moving house, so that's why he's not here. Other than that, though, let's rock and roll.
So, obviously, apologies we couldn't make last week's session. I got called into work and had to do some work. So one of the things we did do, and I will post it in chat, is we created a straw poll last week to allow people to influence what would happen in this session. Now, don't worry about voting for now, because we've already taken the views from it. Although, if you want to vote and change the decision, I may well incorporate more than one of these votes into the session today. However, at the moment, the vote which is leading is they come upon an abandoned mysterious ship in the river, which will happen later on. We'll probably wait till Rachel gets back before we introduce that one. Again, this is similar to what you guys can do when you influence it via hitting follower goals, etc. You can come up with a series of suggestions, we put them in a straw poll, you guys vote in them, and then we try and incorporate them to the stream. Just add that little bit of interactivity to the chat. So, you guys then, so you were on this boat, you've kind of woken up the next day, and it's morning, so it's probably, the boat starts, you hear a lot of activity on the boat from about 6 when the sun comes up. If I remember correctly, Will, you'd actually made friends with the chef the previous
time. I had, yes. The chef is a cook who uses the kind of meats that I like, by which I mean human flesh. And we bonded over that shared experience, traded recipes, that sort of thing.
Yeah, so you kind of wake up to the smell of bacon being wafted in front of your nose as the chef kind of nudges you and hands you a metal plate of what looks like bacon.
Oh,
try this.
Thank you. Mm. I'm a little bit kind of croaky in the morning. Australia, he kind of gets up and his one kind of skin grafted hand, which looks like it's probably not from a human, takes up the meat and starts kind of chewing away. He's like, quite nice. What's the name of the chef again? I would have asked it at some point. I mean,
I can't remember if we actually gave the chef a name.
Oh,
I
just name him Bill.
Bill. Bill and Rick. they can't say K's in this world, so they're just
we'll call the chef Belial.
Belial, okay. So, excellent, Belial. Particularly smoky today. I like what you did with that.
He kind of leans close and he whispers to you, goes, yes, very fresh. Came into a bit of meat last night.
Oh, really? Well, I continue to chew down even more. Well, the fresher it comes, you know. Whereabouts are we on the ship? I'm not used to sailing.
So, you guys are pretty much on the deck, so it's quite a small ship. So while the captain has like a small tent at the rear of the ship where he sleeps, everyone else sleeps on deck. There's a few areas of the ship hull which are set down a little bit, and some people kind of try and cram into there out, you know, underneath a blanket, somewhere in the shade of the sun. There is like oars, but the oars are the winds. There's a nice breeze at the moment, so the sail's up, so the oars are actually just kept at the side of the ship at the moment. The crew aren't having to row. Most of the crew seem to be sort of going about their sort of morning activities, just checking the boat over after night, making sure there's no damage.
Right.
A few of the crew are like washing down the deck, and then the chef goes round and hands out like sort of breakfast, which seems to consist of bacon and eggs, effectively. So,
nice.
I'm not quite sure. The egg, definitely, it's quite a large egg, so it's definitely not from like a hen that you may be used to, but it does appear quite tasty.
I'll eat it. And I kind of walk about deck, I guess. I look out onto the waters. Do I see coast, or is it just out open sea?
Yeah, you do. And make a perception test, Will, since you're having a look out. So, Scarlet, what are you doing while Will does this?
Probably just kind of keeping to my own. If anything, conversing with the captain of the ship to just kind of like get an idea of like what's going on, what's his experience, how long is it going to take, et cetera, et cetera.
Yeah, so the captain's like, oh yeah, we're making good pace. Generally, it takes about 4 days if we don't hit any issues in the river. Occasionally, trees or branches come down. Occasionally, a sandbank shifts, and we've hit that in the past. But they're unusual activities, unusual occurrences. I'm pretty sure we'll make the free city within a week at most. We're certainly moving as fast as anyone could on horseback. So if you're worried about people pursuing you. No, the chance of someone catching us up at the moment is very slim.
I'm gonna kind of like waltz into this conversation, I suppose, kind of like overhearing with one of my ears.
One of the many
yeah. ears.
So the chef comes over and hands yourself, Scarlet, and the captain like some breakfast. And meanwhile, Will's attention seems to be getting drawn to the bank. And Will, you can see bunny rabbits frolicking in the
oh
jungle.
Oh my god, Le Warren confirmed.
At the edge of the jungle.
It's happening. I look out and I wish I could be one of them. A single tear rolls down his eye.
So the boat passes upstream quite quickly. Yeah. You guys make a perception roll, please.
Yes, sir.
Together. So, my perception is a plus one. What level are we? One, okay.
Yeah, I got 15.
Hey, so you kind of both notice this. You're kind of sitting around about probably about an hour into the morning, and you're just sitting on deck, and you can see Rachel's character sitting there, like cleaning off the sword that she picked up off one of the guards. But as you're kind of looking around, you're thinking, well, that's weird. There's one of us missing, and you can't see Skaggeth's character anywhere. And bear in mind, this is a small boat.
I'm gonna...
Did I hear the chef say that the meat was especially fresh?
No. No,
only one.
I think nothing of it. I continue to eat my bacon. The delicious, delicious bacon.
Mm-mm, tastes like paladin.
Tastes lawful good. I dig in. Oh, he probably got on a little trip, hasn't he? Probably taken one of the lifeboats, I'd assume, and cut dry. No? I assume
so. So, like, just kind of look at you funny.
Well, there doesn't appear to be any sort of any boats or small craft. I mean, the boat is quite small, so you probably would have noticed. But the boat does. I mean, the water doesn't appear particularly deep. You know, the boat is quite the river's quite shallow, and the boat doesn't have high draft on it.
Right.
So it could well be that he has in the night decided that maybe
yeah,
it doesn't
slip
have
away.
Company.
That's what I think, Kaffa. I would assume so. He's probably. I got an odd feeling from him. You know when you get that feeling from someone, and Stritic like strokes it, like itches his face with like the false hand. Far too lawful good for my liking. Anyway, Captain, what is there to do aboard this ship? Do you have any specimens for me?
Specimens? He looks at you strangely.
I forget I'm not in the Shadow Realm sometimes. the PLT, Paladin Lettuce Tomato. something to do. Any test subjects around? You know, slaves that you don't like that need to be punished? Anything like that?
Oh, no, no. Everyone on the boat's a free man. We don't, you know, coming from the Free City myself, you know, we we managed to escape a capture long ago. I mean, it's quite a story, actually, our whole ship.
I'm sure it is, yes, excellent. Well, I'll be in my cabin if you need me, or I need you.
He kind of looks around, cabin?
Yes. I go off, yes.
And then he looks as if he was about to inquire more, but then actually as the smell drifts away along with you, he actually seems quite refreshed that you've actually went away from him, and the smell is kind of drifting away somewhere else now.
Fair enough, I mean, I'm used to it.
So Rachel, while you were away, basically...
Rachel's already here, shit, okay, that was my bad.
Thanks, Will.
You going to join in, Rachel?
Will uses a different view from us.
Yeah, so I'm okay. I don't yeah, get it all in right, until
I'll forgive him this once. Okay. I've just been lurking for the last half hour, don't worry.
Yeah, I was going to say, like, how long have you been here, Rach? Like...
So, Rachel, you're literally, I mean, we've only really just started, so we did a quick recap. The guys have woken up in the morning on the boat. They've had some breakfast. They've kind of looked at what the crew are doing. The crew are just kind of keeping an eye on the ship, etc.
Okay.
The thing that sort of like Scarlet's character comes over to you a little bit later. You were just really kind of like maintaining the weapons that you'd managed to salvage off the guard after you'd had some breakfast and stuff. And then Scarlet's character comes over to you and he's like, "Have you seen the Paladin?" And as you kind of look around as well, you can't see Skag's character either.
What is the chance that you've killed him off? Like you did my brother in the last game.
On my way past, I hand you some bacon. It's fresh, you know.
Rest in peace, Ferrick.
Bacon. No, Ferrick will survive. He will. I swear he will. I will bring him back from the dead.
By the way, that wasn't even a troll. Like, legit, I hand you bacon.
Is it...
Yeah, I mean, the ship was actually pretty well provisioned, so the breakfast actually consisted of a hot meal. So literally it was like bacon and eggs and a lot of bread.
No, now, don't start this again already.
The eggs actually, the eggs, the only thing you noticed strange was the eggs were slightly larger than you'd expect from, say, like a hen from your home world, because obviously this is a jungle world, so maybe the eggs are like ostrich or some other critter. So they're quite large, you know, egg size sort of omelets.
Chocobo eggs.
Yeah.
Best omelette ever.
But yeah, yeah.
I'm going on a piece of bacon now. I'm happy.
Yeah. Yeah, it's nice. It tastes nice. You have a nice filling filling meal. And then you look around and yeah. So I mean, Scarlet and sort of Will's character and Scarlet's character, they're not sure what's happened to Skag. They reckon maybe being a paladin, he didn't particularly agree with your company, and he decided to.
How dare he?
Night.
Okay.
The ship, you know, the ship does go quite close to shore at night, so it is possible that happened.
I'm guessing it's not one of these things that's worth investigating on, because let's face it, it's a ship.
Yeah.
If he was going to disappear, somebody would have seen him disappear.
So just as you guys are contemplating that, you hear one of the crew shout, "Ship! Captain, ship!" And you can see him.
Very rude.
You can see him. Like, there's a ship, it almost looks grounded on the side of the bank. It's a bigger ship than this one. It looks like some sort of cargo ship. The wood, you know, it looks like it's run aground or it's been attacked. Maybe there's no obvious sign of that, of like an attack. But the actual wood on the side of it splintered. Now whether that's from when it ran aground or something else, you don't know. But it's obviously in the distance at the moment and getting closer and closer. So what do you guys want to do?
I go over to the side. I guess like we go over to the side to like look out at it. And I say, some kind of cargo ship. Perhaps it might have some specimens for me if any die along the way. Though most likely, it looks like they probably got to shore with their cargo. Might not be too much on board. What say you?
Shame for you, then, isn't it? No fresh parts.
Agreed, it is easier with the fresh, but trust me, I can work with the rotten.
Okay. Can I have a look to see if there's any other ships nearby that may have noticed?
No, I mean, the river's quite narrow, so Okay. You can't see any other sort of ships in the vicinity. So you can hear the captain shouting orders in a language. Well, actually, you do understand the language now because you ate the berries. So you hear the captain kind of calling for the sail to be pulled in and for the crew to ready the anchor. And it seems as if the captain's intending to pull alongside the ship.
Is there any like smoke or any sound of a fire or?
No, it's definitely quiet at the moment. I mean, you can hear the sound of the jungle, so you can hear like parrots and birds and stuff like that in the jungle on the side. But you can't hear anything else. So you guys can make a perception roll then, please.
With pleasure.
Indeed. Let me see here. Perception. 15. 15 is like a 13. Rock star roll.
I'm not used to boats. I'm from Desert Town.
I'm not from Boat Town.
His name, so I mean.
Yeah, y'all don't know
nothing. I'm from Desert Town. I'm not from no Boat Town.
Basically, yeah. Like, that's honestly kind of correct.
So, Will, you notice this first, followed by Nyx. So, Will, you notice this, there's people standing on deck.
Okay.
And then as you're kind of looking at them a little bit closer, you realize they're not moving.
They are not. Are they lying down on the floor, not moving, or are they standing still, not moving? They kind of like look like they're dead,
No, are they standing or lying down?
They're frozen in space, in place. So it's almost as if they were moving at the time, and then they suddenly stopped.
So I say, it looks like maybe some paralysis upon them. My eye isn't quite what it used to be. I got off this old Minotaur, but this one is quite good, fresh, and it looks like they are stuck in place, not moving. I believe definitely still, or well,
so you hear a voice behind you from Rick, the slave master guy. So the first thing is that
as much phlegm as possible in that name.
So he's not from Wales.
The first thing was he was coming over to you going, this bacon is really good. And then he goes, oh, slaves, as he looks at the boat. And then he kind of goes, yeah, this is what happens if you don't renew the magical the enchantment. And he seems to go, you notice as you sort of turn to look at him, you notice he's getting quite pale and himself as he kind of realizes that the same thing could happen to him. And as you get closer, you notice that the people on the deck have turned to stone.
That's not good.
Ah, I see. Well, I suppose we should see. I'd quite like to investigate those bodies, if you don't mind. And perhaps they might have cargo useful for us, you know, water, food.
Yeah, so this is like a two-deck ship. So there's like there's the deck, and then there's a below deck area. So this ship's a bit bigger than the one that you guys are on, but obviously it's not seaworthy at the moment or river worthy. It's crashed in here. So maybe they lost control when obviously what happened. But you notice there's three forms of people: two guys and one woman. You know, literally frozen in place. As if they were, one of them seems to be reaching for the other one, as if maybe one of them turned like a few seconds afterwards and realized what was happening. The captain orders for the anchor. And bear in mind, the captain's only got a very small crew of two or three people. So he comes over to you guys and goes, my guys will man the crossbows just in case anything comes out of the jungle. You know, we're in a bit of there's a lot of wildlife in this particular area. If you want to go and have a quick look, anything you find in the cargo hold, we'll give you a share of, the same with the rest of the crew.
Very well. I wish to journey out there. What say you two?
Might be something useful to scavenge, I suppose.
I agree.
I'm getting something out of it than I'm in.
Good. Then let us go.
On one condition, that you don't take too many body parts. Don't fancy cuddling up to dead pieces of body again.
Cuddling up to stone, I don't think they're going to be much use to them.
And thanks so much to Tyrone Biggs for following. Welcome to the adventure, Tyrone. You're a gentleman and a scholar. So I say, yes, oh, yes.
The crew kind of use grappling hooks to pull the two boats together. So literally you can, with a little bit of care and caution, you can step across. So I will have you each roll a d20 just in case anyone rolls a 1, but other than that, it's straightforward to cross over. On
just, I love the way just say just in case somebody rolls a 1.
I always like to give that the opportunity to influence by donating. And
Nat 20, I fly over.
The old man with astounding grace jumps up onto the rail basically and bounds across, clearly excited by the opportunity to examine these stone corpses.
Now, on a nat 20, we realize that Stredic actually doesn't have body weight and he just walks across the river.
So you're on the deck of this this ship. So there's as I say, there's three humanoids. Two guys, one woman, who have clearly been turned to stone. And as you kind of get closer and kind of touch them, it is actually almost like a Medusa effect, that their actual body has been transformed completely into stone.
Well, it appears that they have indeed turned into stone. That was aforementioned to happen if they ran out of time. Looks like probably escaped slaves who failed on their mission. Rather pitiful, if you ask me.
You do notice, so actually make a perception roll.
Sure.
All of us or just him?
Will can have advantage. You guys can all make the roll, but Will can have advantage.
19!
Not that he needs it.
What's that?
Will is the only one who notices this. So Will, you do notice that actually the bronze bands that the slaves are wearing haven't changed to stone and are still on the wrists of the slaves.
Ah.
And also you can notice that's on the left wrist. On the right wrist, the magical mark almost looks much more like a physical indentation in their skin now, whereas the one that you've seen with Rick before is more like a tattoo. So almost as if that was what caused the paralysis or the stone effect.
If
I look more closely at them, does it actually look like they're solid stone or just like they're encased in stone?
How do you want to examine them?
I start tapping
them
away.
Yeah, I was going to say, tap them, like...
with?
My axe, but gently.
Yeah, so you tap them with your axe, and it's almost like tapping a rock. It certainly appears to be solid stone.
No, Will.
It turns out they're not solid, guys. Don't worry.
Are they children, by any chance?
So I point out the wristband situation. I say, all right, looks like they have developed somewhat into the final form, if you will. Interesting to know that we might not have all that much time.
Bear in mind, you guys weren't marked. You guys escaped before you were marked. Rick's the one that is marked.
Yeah, okay. So I say,
as a silver slave, he has slightly more time than the bronze slaves would, because the silvers tended to be the mark was regenerated on a monthly basis. Now, okay. You've not obviously had that discussion with Rick.
Yeah, so I say, well, we'll be fine, but it looked like our friend Rick might be, fucked.
You can see that Rick's kind of, he's out of view on the other side of the ship, seeming to be contemplate his fate in silence himself on the other side of the ship that you were on. He's not come across onto this ship with you guys. So you guys are on the ship, so you've got these three people who definitely look like slaves. You know, they're not carrying weapons. Their clothes, admittedly turned stone now, do appear to be quite ragged. There's at the front of the ship, there's like a small hatchway that seems to go down into what you assume is the ship's hold.
Okay. So we go down.
Before we go down, is it possible I can remove the bracelets from the stone people?
If I had a gold coin for every time I heard that.
They're basically just sitting loosely. It's almost as if someone had taken a bracelet and put it on a statue, so they can be taken off, yes.
Does anything happen to them when I do take them off?
No.
Okay, I'll pocket them for now.
I'm gonna loot the ship.
So, right, so you're going down to the hold then?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Who's going first?
I'm gonna head down to
it. Probably because I didn't really care about the statues all that much. I just kind of accepted it and moved on.
Yeah, so while Nyx and Will were examining these statues, Scarlet, you kind of went ahead and descended these steps. One of the crew had given you like a lantern beforehand, let's assume there's a lantern kind of like hanging up that you can take out of like a little crate on the way down into the hold. So you fish out a lantern basically, and you take it down, and you The lantern literally descends into a large cargo hold that runs all the way to the back of the ship, although there does appear to be some rooms at the back of the ship as well, at the back of the cargo hold. At the moment, it appears that as if the cargo hold seems to be taken up by barrels, wooden sort of really large ale sort of size barrels.
Is there anything besides those in there, or is that just the majority?
There's a few random crates and sacks, but the majority of it, the vast majority of it, all is these barrels.
Okay. As I'm kind of exploring through the area, I'm gonna be like knocking on the barrels to see if it's obviously liquid inside or if it's a solid. And if it's a solid thing inside it, I'm gonna stop and try and get it open.
No, there's definitely liquid inside them, and you can actually see that the barrels have like a tap.
Oh, okay.
Where someone would, you know, tap the barrel effectively. To open it out.
Alright, in that case I'm going straight for those crates.
Right, you head over towards the crates, and you open up the crates, and in the crates you find you find a number of different items. So you find a small amount of currency. Welcome. So the equivalent of about
one Shognor. Welcome, Shognor, to the adventure. You're a gentleman and a scholar. Thank you for joining
us. Find the equivalent of about 30 gold coins in local currency, in this sort of like in a little leather pouch, carefully stowed away in this.
I am fine with it.
You also find a what looks like a short sword of some description, but it appears to be very well made.
Sweet.
Other than that, there's nothing in this particular sort of crate. It almost looks as if it's rather than actually being a crate, it almost just looks as if it's being used by as storage by someone, like almost like a chest.
Hmm. Okay.
Find anything good? I say, like, undoing the tap to run some liquid.
So you undo the tap, Will, and you this orangey liquid sort of pours out, and there's a really, really sweet smell that comes out. You kind of put your finger in it, basically taste it. And it tastes like a really, really rich and exotic juice.
I think it might be dwarf blood. Yes, an excellent vintage, I'd say at least 212 years old, by my reckoning.
Hold on, dwarf blood is orange?
Invariably, yes. Well, once it goes through the process, you see, it's imbibed with different fluids and spices.
I never want to visit your world.
Oh, well, you should be much more right about our world visiting you. I say we take these barrels and bottle them for something with the captain, or when we get to the Free City. I dare venture that it would be worth something.
Dwarf blood. I don't think I'm ever going to understand you.
Well, it's quite simple, my dear. Dwarfs are creatures
don't
which have
try.
Blood.
Let's
well, they...
just go.
I can explain the process sometime if you'd be interested. Anyway,
I think we'll have the time for. We've got a few days travel ahead of us.
I think we need some fit young men down here. The Carolese barrels. I'm far too old. My back can't take it.
So, Will, you go back out onto deck to tell the captain what you found and to see if some of the crew can come across and
dwarf's
help move
blood
out.
Everywhere.
Well, when you're speaking to the captain, he does notice on your hand the kind of orangey colour, and he goes, "Dwarf's blood, don't be silly. That looks like mustard juice. It's a quite a rare fruit. How much is down there?"
Nah. Several barrels.
Ah, this could definitely be enhance our profits on this journey. We'll need to be careful not to overload it. But yes, I'll send some crew over shortly, and we'll start moving them. Yeah. Meanwhile, in the cargo hold, people in the cargo hold can make a perception test, please.
Mm-hmm. Boy, oh boy!
Your dude is here.
Yeah.
How are you going to come down? Perception.
Put Shredding in a barrel. You would enjoy it.
I see F all.
Well, you see, I do have gills, so I am.
So make a dex save, please, Nyx.
Oh no!
The dwarf blood attacks.
Wait, do I
you.
Need to as well?
No.
Oh,
apparently
wow.
You're
it was
fine.
Damn.
Six.
Oh boy.
Get wrecked.
Here we go. Go on.
Take...
When the rabbits rise up.
You take one point of damage, a whole 1 point of damage.
Get rabbited.
Yeah.
You don't start.
Stick it to the man.
You trip over the stone form of another slave that seemed to have been lying on between the barrels, basically, as you were exploring. There's only one torch, and Scarlet had it, so you were kind of having a look around just to see if there's anything else there, and you tripped over the body of this slave who's turned to stone, effectively, and you kind of come crashing down on top of it. And actually, just as you're crashing down on top of it, you kind of see the head rolling off.
Oh.
You wonder. I mean, you know now it is stone throughout the whole head. So as the head rolls off, it's almost like a statue's head rolling off.
Okay.
If I had a gold piece every time I heard that.
So how many more crates were there besides the one that I opened?
The rest of the crates are just empty, but there does appear to be, as you get towards the back of the cargo hold, there does appear to be rooms at the back of the ship as well.
And in I go.
So you go into the back of this room, and there's like a captain's cabin. And the first thing you immediately see is a girl, maybe she's maybe 17 or maybe a little bit younger than that.
Perfect number.
She's wearing slave clothes, and she's holding up her hand like this. And this hand is glowing, and this hand has turned to stone. And she seems able to have so far stopped the stone transformation process traveling further down her arm, but there's literally sweat pouring off her, and you can see she's exhausted. She's almost like she's almost not realized you're there at the moment. She's concentrating so hard on stopping this transformation process.
I'm gonna shout back out the door for like anyone that can hear me to rush over here.
Suddenly there's a stretch.
What do you shout?
I just say that I found somebody who's still alive.
I'm like down there like a shot. I cast Misty Step and I'm down there. Suddenly Stretic's in the room. Yes!
There's a body. Okay, I'm following after the possessed being, yes.
Yeah, so you guys get into this back. Well, actually, it's the cabin's at the front. The cabin's at the back because you guys went down the front and then walked all the way back down the back of the ship. So this cabin's kind of below at the back of the ship. And you can see there's this girl here. There's like literally a pool of sweat around her, and she's kind of, she looks completely exhausted. She's almost shaking. And you can see, as I said, one of her hands is almost seems to be glowing with magic, as she seems to have been able to stop the transformation at the point where she's holding onto it. But her other hand is literally turned to stone so far.
Fascinating process. Hello, my dear. My name is Stretic. I'll be your physician for today.
So no, you will not be her physician for today. Don't trust him.
Looks like you're in a spot of bother here. So what spell are you currently casting to hold back the tide of imminent death, as it were?
So you can make a arcana roll, Will.
I swear I'm going to remove all of Stretic's tongues.
Looks here like a nat 20. Fuck, I know everything about this shit.
Also, I wish you the best of luck in finding them all, Rachel.
So, Will, you can sense straight away she's not casting a spell. She seems to be using divine power.
It has the stench of a god about it. I say, all right then, looks like I probably can't be of too much help here.
She looks at you guys through, there's like tears running down the corners of her eyes, and she's just barely able to say, help me.
She says help her. I'm trying my best, my dear, but you're not being very helpful.
Stretic, shut up. I pick up the girl, I take her all the way back to the ship. I instantly pick her up and carry her.
I have a trained physician back there for just this.
Right, make a... Oh, this is going to be interesting. How do you avoid banging her head off the...
Amberfall, this girl dies because we move her.
I would say either a dex or perception.
Yeah, I'm thinking...
A dexception.
I'll let you have the choice of either athletics or acrobatics to carry this girl in a careful way through the cramped hold onto the deck. So I'll give you the choice.
Nat 20!
Yeah, so you basically...
ready to pick any bits that fall off.
you lift her up and you carry her onto deck into the sunlight. And as you kind of come out on deck, turns around and sort of looks over in complete surprise at this. Obviously, he's realised what's going on with the slaves on the deck. But a lot of the crew almost come over in hushed whispers. And you can see Rick, he comes over and he sort of like, he bounds over and goes, I've never seen this before. How is she doing that?
It's a work of a god or goddess. Filthy magic, if you ask me.
It's obviously working, though.
For now, she will soon die.
So, Nyx, everyone make a perception test, please. Nyx, you have advantage to that since you are holding her.
Fascinating to see the process at work, though. I'm taking
before
notes.
I leave the ship, did I find anything in the captain's quarters?
If you want to stay in the captain's quarters and search, you can. So yes, that's fine. I'll cover that off in a second then. So cool. Will, you notice that the stone effect is creeping underneath her hand that she's holding on.
Oh look, the process is working. It's quite a strong magic, isn't it? Look, where's your god now?
Always a sympathetic one, are we?
Well, I say we cut off the hand.
Will, roll intimidation.
All right.
I was going to say, that's probably one of the only options we've got. It's turned into a zombie game now.
It's a four.
No, she manages to ignore your taunting, shall we say. she manages to maintain concentration on whatever
right,
she's doing.
I'm going to use my shadow. I'm going to use my shadow magic to attempt to fight the stone. Or whatever kind of source of magic. I imagine on that 20, I know what the source of magic is, whether it's like divine or like shadow or like fire or something like that. Or,
So make an arcana roll, Will, actually, given your character's knowledge of this.
I'm guessing it might be earth. So on a 19.
So you reckon you're not. So according to what you had a very quick conversation with Rick, and he sort of like says, you know, there's no point even cutting her hand off. It's too late. The spell's taken effect. People have tried that before to try and beat the spells, but the magic's too late. But then you're starting thinking, and he goes, what if we were to transfer the hand rather than cut it off?
Ah, I have a solution. We perform a transplant. Now, who here needs a new hand? No. Well, that's too bad. Pick someone. I say, if we move the hand from this body onto the next, then, wait. I have an even better idea. Come, bring her back to the other ship, Will, or bring one of the stone people here. Someone bring the stone people over here. One of the already paralyzed. Well, come on.
Okay, fine. I'll go and get one of the stone people, the nearest one.
So that's going to be a strength test with disadvantage.
With disadvantage?
Unless someone's going to help you.
But I'm a barbarian, isn't that enough?
Well, if you want to rage, then yes, you'd be fine. But have it as a straight roll, and then we'll make the difficulty higher. So let's call.
No. Just no.
Yeah. So you step over and you whatever stone is used in this is a particularly heavy and dense stone. And so you just can't seem to lift this on your own.
Captain, get some men to help. There's no time to waste. I need this specimen. I need it.
So the captain for a couple of people to jump over, basically, and carry over the statue with the help of Nyx's character. So meanwhile, in the cabin, so Scarlet, so you're rooting around this cabin of this ship.
Uh-huh.
So the actual cabin seems to be reasonably well appointed. It does appear as if the slaves have almost been squatting in the cabin as such. So they've taken, like, rather than sort of stay elsewhere, they've all brought their bedrolls into the cabin, it's a little bit more luxurious. I mean, it's not luxury in any shape or form, but it's better than in the cargo hold or whatever. You do find there is a small locked chest at the back of the cabin. And there's like a table with various journals and stuff. Nothing of particular interest, but this locked chest does draw your eyes to it.
Okay. I do have a crowbar in my inventory. Would I be able to try and pry it open?
You can do, yes. Do you want to try and use brute force to just pry it open?
Yeah, I'm going to try and kind of jack it open using the crowbar.
Right, so that'll be strength then. I will lower, rather than give you advantage, I will lower the difficulty because you've got the crowbar, but it's still...
Fair enough.
It will.
Hey!
Right.
You can place the crowbar.
That's a natural
You stick the crowbar in basically like that, and then you go... And then all of a sudden the cabin explodes in flames.
What?
Oh, boy.
For 14 points of damage.
Oh, damn.
And, oh, God.
And make a constitution saving throw DC 12 if you fail it, you're on fire.
Oh, jeez.
Oh, wow.
Saving throw, okay. Oh, thank God.
Yep. So you guys, just as the crew are literally carrying with Nyx's character this statue across between the ships, the back end of the ship explodes, forced apart slightly, and they drop the statue down between the two ships.
I say, Captain, listen, if we don't have a body, this girl is going to die, which I'm fine with, but I feel like you might not be. Now, is there a willing man here?
So, Will, you feel a tugging a tugging on your your shirt.
Am I close?
And,
hello?
Belial's standing there. Hello, and he kind of whispers in you and goes, I've got a body.
I look at him and I say,
nonsense again.
Can you bring that unfortunate sailor who fell overboard here? Or do we need to...
No, can you come to me?
Yes, of course. That's more convenient for us anyway.
He leads you to the front of the deck. He leads you to the front of the ship, and he opens up part of the deck hold, and he shows you what's in inside. And I'll Twitch chat you it.
Okay.
Secret.
Oh boy. The secrets are real. Oh, by the way, I'll take this point on the hour to remind you guys, if you're enjoying the show, hit that follow button and join us. We are just 8 followers away from a viewer decision where you guys are going to decide what happens next to us. So, like Pixie Gal says in chat, we could have some more rabbit ears being placed on everyone today. We could become full weeaboo if you really wanted. So,
I'll tell you what, let's do it this way. So, if Scarlett and Nyx could take their headphones off temporarily until I go with that.
Yeah, we can hear the chat.
Okay. So the chat can hear as well.
And also, if you haven't tweeted, hit the tweets. 20 retweets, you guys can decide what happens next. Okay, David.
So, in the space of the hole, there was the unconscious form of Skag's character missing his arm.
Perfect. Everyone spam ERP RIP, and they won't know what it means. And they'll be like, what does that mean? So I nod to him, I give him a look, I say, excellent, I say, we'll bring the girl in there. So,
yeah.
I guess we can.
So what you plan to do?
Like close the door so that I have like a closed working space, so that no one else can come in, basically.
And then what? You're just going to replace?
And then I'm going to replace the hand on Skaggeth's character.
Right. Cool. Right. You guys can put your headsets back on.
All right.
So I can see your tombstones in chat. Who's died?
So you guys see you guys see Will's character conferring with Belial, the ship's cook at the front of the ship. Meanwhile, Nyx, you're trying to work out whether you can get back over and get another one of the stone statues at the moment.
Yeah.
Meanwhile, maybe possibly, although Scarlett's not your brother in this one, so you probably don't care. He's dying in flames in the burnt off cabin. So. Yeah.
I don't know where he is.
Well, you know, he was going to investigate the cabin, and you know the cabin's the bit that just exploded.
In that case, yes, I'll go and try and find him. There we go. So
you dive over to try and recover Scarlett's body from the burnt out wreck of the cabin.
Like charred body.
Yeah.
The guilt doesn't work with Mara. Don't try it.
And thanks to Reeb Joe for following. Welcome, my friend. To the adventure, you're a gentleman and a scholar. By the way, whilst this is happening, I'm getting the girl's body taken inside to that room, and I'm closing the door, and I'm doing a... I can't work in these conditions! I close the door and lock it with Belial inside with me.
Yeah.
God.
So, quick question, really quick. When it exploded, did I, like, go unconscious or anything like that, or am I still, like, like able to do anything?
I think you're probably dazed, so you're kind of deafened. Although you're badly burnt from the damage you've taken, so your skin's all very tender. The whole place is filled with like a thick smoke at the moment. You've lost your lantern.
You're tender and crispy, southern fried.
I'm sure Strick would love it.
You kind of stagger out into what you kind of remember the cargo hold is, but literally your character's out of it almost at the moment. How many hit points you got left, by the way?
That was a bit of damage.
Took 14 at level one.
That's okay.
I took 14.
You guys are level three though, aren't you?
Yeah, we're level three. I took 14, which is.
That's okay. So yeah, you're
the better half.
You're seriously injured, shall we say, and you're pretty dazed. So Nix, you get down to the cargo hold, and you see that the whole place is filled with this black acrid smoke now, and you can see parts of the ship have caught on fire. This juice in these barrels appears to be particularly flammable as well, and you can see that the pool of it where Will had emptied it, but without bothering to close it, it's kind of starting to pool. That had been pooling on the floor, so you can kind of see the flames have started to lick into that.
Bloody Stretic. Okay. I look for the man who has no name, and I find out if he's okay, if he's severely injured, give him any like medical care.
So make a perception roll with disadvantage.
Disadvantage.
Yeah, there's smoke everywhere.
Oh, that one.
Nailed it. Got smoke in your
eyes. Don't
now
even
you
see my
see.
Fingers.
Now you become smoke.
So you're searching around, calling out the name of whatever.
We don't know.
Remember, guys, passive smoking kills.
Right, so you're literally calling out. Are you there? Follow the sound of my voice, and then you basically slip on a liquid and end up flat in this flaming liquid.
Follow the sound of my voice.
You take half of what he took.
I would say much fun,
5 points of damage and make a constitution. Only 10 for you. You need to get to make sure you're not on fire. Oh, you're on fire.
Two nat ones.
And you roll a one, so you get damage immediately.
Oh no.
Let me take the first five off. Hold on.
Rest in
pepperoni.
Oh boy.
Rest in
pepperoni.
And another six.
And another six.
And basically, you're going to have to make a dexterity to roll yourself out each turn, or you'll take D8 plus one damage per turn while you're burning.
Kentucky Fried Extra Crispy, okay.
So that's the end of the first round with you guys then. So if you two can roll initiative just so I know who to do first.
Sure, may as well.
This is encouraging. I should play some more exciting music for the scene, I feel. Whilst
you're
burning.
Got like flames and timbers burning.
Yeah! I need to watch the movie again.
Right, so Nix, have you rolled? Right, so yeah, so Scarlet, your character's going first. So you've kind of staggered out, and you're kind of listening, and you can hear this crackling noise of fire all around you, and you can hear this like the timbers starting to creak, and obviously this ship's all made of wood, so there's a good chance the decking might start coming down as well. What do you want to do? Do you want to start staggering towards the direction where you think the exit is?
I'm gonna do two things. The first thing is really quickly try to look around to see if anything valuable was damaged or is still available to be taken.
No, but you do manage to grab that short sword out of the chest.
Okay, sweet.
So you managed to retrieve that and plus the gold.
All right. In that case, I'm heading out.
Make a survival roll to kind of get your bearings. Yeah, so you manage to get your bearings and you start to head down the ship. It's going to take you two turns to get out of the ship. Nix, so you need to, first thing, before you take any damage, you need to make a, well, unless you want to roll yourself out using something other than dex. So if you've got some sort of magic idea, then feel free. If not,
not off the top of my head, no.
So it would be dex save 12 to put the flames out.
I don't want to.
And
burn.
Thanks to Mashamino for following. Welcome to Avenge, my friend. You're a gentleman. And a scholar.
Next save coming up.
Oh, one off! One off!
Oh, come on! I don't want to burn.
Just saying, wouldn't it be smarter to just like run out of the ship and jump into the water?
Well, yeah,
I've got to get out of the liquid.
No, she needs to properly baste herself in an oil first, Scarlet.
So given you got so close, I'll say that you've managed to roll out some of the flames, and you're only taking half damage now, so take 2 additional points of damage. So the D4 rather than the D8. So take 2 points of damage. So Scarlet, you hear like the sound of a female in pain.
Thank goodness it's not Stretic, that's all I can say.
So top of the round, so Scarlet, your character's got halfway through. You know roughly where the entrance and the way up is, and you can kind of see that there's flames everywhere now. So the first thing you're going to have to do is you're going to have to make a dex save to dodge the beam that's about to fall down.
Oh, goody.
Yeah, hey. So basically this, you kind of get this inkling as you kind of hear this creaking noise above you as this flaming beam comes down around you, and you manage to roll underneath it. And then you make a perception test. It's DC 12 to spot Nyx's character.
See me? Don't see me!
Honestly, knowing Alex, he probably wouldn't have stopped to begin with.
You don't need to tell her that, though. You could have been the hero. You could have just said, I wanted to save you, but I rolled crap.
I'm going to be true to the character.
You
Alex is an asshole.
On the plus side, you think we're going to have smoky bacon tomorrow.
Ooh.
I'm so hungry right now.
I know.
So, Scarlet, so you manage to head out, and you basically break through the smoke and come out on deck. Nyx, your character, do you want to try and run for it while on fire and take the damage, or do you want to try and roll yourself out? You can hear that the ship is definitely in a bad state, and there's the, you know...
Oh,
the,
let's just leg it. I figured out why Alex couldn't see me, though. It's because my hair's red, so I was incognito in disguise.
You were blending in.
You don't have any hair anymore.
Oh, that is just me!
It's realistic.
I could think of so many names for you right now. What do you mean to roll to run out?
You take 3 points of damage. You need to roll...
I haven't even done anything yet!
Yeah, but you're on fire, so you're running on fire. Oh. So you need to make a survival roll to work out your bearings and get out.
Horrible man. 14.
Yes. So you run out onto deck basically, and then dive into the water, I assume, putting out the flames. And what? So next round, you're out. Scarlet's out. The crew throw you a rope. Next, and Scarlet, you manage to make it to the ship, and the. The crew are sitting there rapidly trying to push the burning ship away from the ship that they're on now. There's going to be like sort of rods with like the sort of metal hook on the end of them, and they're trying to push the ship away. So some of them have got the oars out, and they're basically maneuvering. The captain's running around frantically shouting orders to get the ship free before the flames spread to this ship. Meanwhile, in surgery land.
Hey!
Oh, for goodness sake.
Surgery land.
Do you want to take a hair again?
I think this one will be a medicine roll.
I agree.
Trying to save her in the back. They're just playing Operation.
Oops.
Where's the buzzer?
However, since you have Bilal assisting you.
I do. With
knives, I'll give you an advantage on it.
All right. Medicine. 12.
Yeah, that's fine. You're 12-12. So you managed to detach the stone hand with your first roll, and now you need to make another roll to attach the replacement hand.
Oh boy. Okay. Removal is complete. Now on to the second phase.
What is your sewing skill like?
19.
Yeah, so you managed to attach the replacement hand.
Sounds about
right. And you make an arcana test. No.
Okay. This is going to be like my last character with sewing people's eyes shut.
Arcana reads 19. God, I'm
yeah, and good. You reckon using your arcane knowledge, you've managed to intricately break the ritual as part of what you've done. So, and the girl's obviously unconscious now. She kind of lost consciousness when you chopped her hand off.
It happens most of the time.
But you acted fast enough.
Good, good. So I look at the creation before me. I say to Belial, well, she'll probably need some rest and the like, but she looks like she'll live. Please don't do anything with this one. I want to study her. You should have enough bacon with this one. And I point to the second body, who shall remain nameless for now.
I was gonna say, the bacon that I got given by Stretic first thing when I turned up, that wasn't really bacon.
Yes, it was.
Are you sure?
It wasn't totally bacon. Yeah.
It wasn't human.
It was that good
no.
bacon.
It may not be pork bacon, it was certainly bacon.
You silly, real person bacon, no. Who's the real person? Okay, I leave the room.
Yeah,
I see the ship burning. Spot above us.
So you come back up on deck, Will, just as kind of...
I pop up on deck. I pop up and the first thing I say is, I told you it was dwarf blood. As I see the burning ship in my head.
So the ship's... By the time Will comes back up on deck, the ship is well on fire. Nyx, you've been fished out of the water, but... Your body's kind of, your hair is, I mean, there's little bits of straddles of your hair gone. If anything, that makes it look worse because it's kind of like patchwork.
Oh, sorry, I loved my hair.
Right.
So, Will, you kind of see that both Scarlet and Nyx's character are like covered in like soot and burns on their body. You see Belial's character sort of like, he comes up as well, and he kind of goes, what the hell's happened here?
Good question. I second that movement. Why don't you have any hair anymore?
Please don't mention it. It's a sensitive subject. I might feel like chopping off one of your limbs.
I can do you a transplant if you want.
False.
It won't be as good as my original.
Well, if we find the right test subject, the follicles can quite easily be removed with some brute force. I've done it a few times.
So, Belial's character rushes over to you with a small satchel, and he goes, I've got some ointment that can help with these burns. And he kind of takes out this jar. There's quite a large sort of like glass jar with like a big cork stopper in it, basically. And it's this like milky white sort of thick like bottle almost. And he goes, this can help if you want. You just need to spear it on where you've taken the burns.
This won't be enough then, we're covered in it.
No, you use it liberally. To be honest, you're not like kind of dying as such. You've taken a lot of damage, but the burns are kind of like maybe an arm or
your clothes
kind of covered off some of it. So you're not, it's not as if your whole body's burned.
Yeah,
I was going to say, the way you were describing this make it sound like we were both trying to do a very bad impression of Stretic, so...
And thank you, generic guy, for following. Welcome to the adventure, my friend. You're a gentleman and a scholar.
This stuff basically heals, let's call it 1d10 wounds of burn damage.
Let's do that now.
So you may roll yourselves.
Oh dear.
Nice.
Bear in mind, you do have some healing potions as well, I think, that you got from earlier.
Just want to find my notes again.
You may obviously also use short rests at the end of the day, etc. So this is kind of, this is late afternoon by the time all of this has happened and stuff. So you kind of use up Belial's kind of like healing salve, and he sort of like looks down at it a little bit disappointed that it's all gone. He goes, it's okay, I'll make some more later.
We didn't have much of a choice, I'm sorry.
Well, yes, I got trapped there. How did that happen, that fire, out of interest?
From what we can tell, something was very flammable on that ship. Just all
the
burned.
Dwarf's blood, I assume. Did you set fire to it for some reason?
I didn't. I went because it burst into flames. I wanted to see if whatever his name was
then
on board.
You, did you attempt to light the dwarf's blood?
Not intentionally. There was something booby-trapped in the captain's office.
Interesting. Does it look like the ship is now like sunk completely?
Yeah.
Well, I suppose those ships are lost.
They've pushed away. You can kind of see like crocodiles starting to like move from the bank to investigate the
wreck.
Fine.
I say, you'll be happy to hear that I have saved the girl's life.
Oh, excellent! How did you manage it?
I managed to transplant the hand, as I suggested before.
Who gave up their hand?
Oh, there was someone who came and then went. Just a good Samaritan. Anyway, you looks like you need some treatment. Can I help you in any way? Your skin looks really crispy. I can attempt to heal.
I think I'll be fine with the wounds. Thank you.
If you need any more skin, just let me know.
I won't.
Well, then I'll just do it when I think you need some.
No!
Stretic brings a whole new...
I will never beg for skin from you.
Stretic brings a whole new meaning to the word, give me some skin. So
later on that, so you guys basically spend most of the afternoon resting up. The captain gets the ship back underway. He's a little bit disappointed that you've not managed to salvage the cargo and obviously improve his profit margin. But he's obviously a bit surprised that you've managed to save the girl's life. He's never heard of someone being saved at that late stage in the ritual. And kind of Rick is kind of looking at her a little bit interestingly, as if kind of like, well, he kind of comes over to your character and he goes, do you think that you'd be able to save me as well?
Well, you see, the process is a difficult one, you see. What we need is a willing host to take the hand, which would mean that someone else would end up dying.
Please tell me that I hear this conversation, because if I do, I'm not going to be sleeping anywhere near him ever.
So Rick leans closer to your Will and goes, what about that crispy guy over there? He's pretty much dead already.
It does appear that way. However, we are somewhat banded together. I will tell you this, my friend. If you can provide me with a body, not of either the woman or the hunter, seeing as I believe them to be useful to me, not because I have any feelings for them, do not mistake that for caring, simply they are good tools. If you can find me perhaps a slave or one of the crewmen who is particularly disliked, bring me his body, and then I will attempt the surgery. However, it will not be free.
Oh, I understand. What about the girl? I could knock her out. She looks pretty weak now.
You see, the girl has just had hers transplanted. I wish to plumb her depths and learn.
he goes, I understand completely, and winks at you.
Oh, God.
Quite. I say, completely believing.
And he kind of leans, goes, I hope I can still plumb people's depths when I'm your age.
I say, well, you see, if you go to medical school, then you can. I'm like... I completely believe that we're talking about science projects here, and nothing more adult than that. So I say, if you bring me the body, then I will name my price.
He goes, yeah, maybe when we reach the Three Cities, it should be easy enough. I've got some money saved. Well, I'm sure we can work something out.
Of course, excellent.
At least I'm not the one getting hit on this session.
So, basically night passes, so you guys can use long rests.
Nice.
So you can roll your hit dice up to your maximum hit dice.
But then we gain them afterwards.
You regain half of them.
Rounded up or down?
I think round down in D&D.
I think so.
Yeah, round down, I believe.
Yeah.
We had some rolling on that.
You've effectively got 3 hit dice, so if you used all of them, then to the next long rest, you would only have 1 available, I think. That's right.
Yeah.
Yeah. Sounds about right. I mean, this game is like survival anyway, so making it more difficult is cool.
So you heal whatever you decide to heal overnight, and then next morning you kind of wake up. And you hear the first thing you hear is a scream from the girl.
Let her be the girl.
She comes around and she's looking at this. You see her. She's holding up. Actually, it would be this way around. She's holding up her hand like that. Make a perception test, please. Everyone.
All right.
Oh,
my rolls really suck today.
13.
So, Scarlett, you notice that the reason why she's obviously screaming is that she's got this. sort of hairy man's hand attached to her. It's like thick black hair along the back of the hand, effectively. Well, and it's been crudely sort of stitched onto. Well, not crudely, it's actually.
That'd have been
very well actually stitched delicate. Onto her. So she's got movement of her hands. You can clearly move it, but she's like.
Wow.
And in fact, that's like a medical marvel if we think about it. Like,
it is,
yeah, I've actually transplanted a fan's.
So I'm the only one that sees that, though.
Yes. You're the only one that notices that the reason why she's screaming is because the hand's a male hand. The rest of them notice, obviously, that she's kind of she's looking at this hand.
I say, listen, I've saved your life, so a little bit of respect and care for my work would be appreciated. And thanks to Plum My Depths for following.
Oh, come on!
Welcome to the adventure, my friend. You're a gentleman and a scholar. I will PM you later.
I mean, if they're asking that nicely.
So at the moment, Belial is going around handing out like breakfast to the crew.
Yeah.
It just appears to be eggs this morning.
Yeah.
Okay.
I say, listen, child, to the girl. My name is Stretik. I have healed your hand. You are alive.
So Rachel, when your character sort of like says to Belial, kind of, only eggs. He goes, well, actually, I was gonna give it to the. Friend, because but friend. I do have. If you're interested, yeah, I do have some meat this morning. If you want some.
You're making it sound very dodgy. What?
Oh, it's a bit of a delicacy. That's why it's
Okay. Sure. Why not?
So he takes out like a cocktail stick.
Yes.
He's got like a meatball on it, and he hands it to you. I was going to give it to your friend over there. You see, he's got one himself that he eats, and he goes, "It's a bit of a delicacy in these parts."
So, you just got a kebab. Congratulations!
Yes,
you got a Skaggeth kebab.
He goes on to serve the rest of the crew. Like these, it's like scrambled eggs, effectively, with. Like a bit of bread and stuff like that.
I don't think Mara would even like consider the idea that she thinks it's a bit suspicious that he's being odd about it, but I don't think she'd think it'd be human, so yeah, she eats it. She's fine with it, like, yeah, not too bad.
The old skeg kebab.
It tastes salty.
Oh no. No.
So I said to the girl, what is your name, child?
She starts going, Sarah, thank you, I think. You saved me, how?
I did. I am a master magician.
So she's like, whose hand is this?
I mean, I'm not wrong. Like, I have literally done something which is not possible in real
That's
life.
That's the problem!
Yeah. Like, perhaps because your character comes from a different world and you're used to this world. Maybe that has managed to...
Yeah, bring, yeah. He's a twisted genius is the problem. Like, he's terrifying.
You could make a fortune setting yourself up in three cities.
I mean, honestly. So I say, yes, you are... Well, welcome, Sarah. What were you doing aboard that ship?
We were fleeing the Citadel. We managed to escape. We were hoping to make it upstream in time. But the ritual acted faster than we suspected. The city was further than we thought, so we were caught. I don't know what happened. For some reason, I had this vision, and then I was able to try and stop the change happening. It was like there was a woman in front of me glowing. I've never seen her before, but she seemed to help me until you came.
Fascinating. Some divine intervention perhaps saved you. Tell me, Zara, are you particularly religious?
No.
Fascinating. Well, it seems like you've been chosen by something or someone to live. And now you're here with us. So, I can shave off...
How can I repay you?
Well,
No.
Well,
no, let's just let him plumb your depths.
I mean...
Oh, come on!
So I say, simply all I want is knowledge. You can tell me everything you know. along the journey. We're going to the Free City, you see.
Yes, that's where we were heading as well.
I can shave off that hair, by the way. I say, looking down to the hairy hand that she's got.
Yeah. So you see Will's character. You see Will's character basically take out a pair of tweezers and he starts picking the hairs out of the back of her hand. And he puts them in his hand and then he turns round to Nyx's character.
No!
We talked about the transplant before.
No.
It would work. This hair
I'd
is...
I'd rather be bald for the rest of my life.
A little bit bristly, but...
No.
Tastes fine to me.
How many limbs have you actually got and how many of them do you want to keep?
Don't ask questions you don't want the answers to. And I...
Good point. Stay away from me.
In that case, and I take the hairs off and I just put them into one of my many deep, dark pockets of terrible things.
Scarlet and Nyx, make a perception roll, please.
Am I going to get in that one again?
A hairy situation.
No, your rolls aren't good tonight, though.
No, they're really not. It's bad. 4.
So the rest of the journey is pretty uneventful. The night before you reach the Free City, though, Scarlet, your character kind of comes around in the middle of the night, and you see Belial pushing this sort of like this hunched over, almost like a sack, from the front of the ship, off the ship, into the waters. And then he kind of just washes his hands free and then goes back to whatever he was doing.
I see nothing, because apparently I don't have eyes anymore.
So bear in mind, he's pushing this over at the front of the ship, so if you want, you can try and dive out. You can try and like move to the side and see if you can see anything about what it was as it goes past you.
Yeah, I'll take a peek over and see if there's like any like tint to the water, like if it's turning red around the bag or anything like that.
Well, the bag, I mean, although it looked like you pushed the sack over, it turns out as it kind of passes you in the water, it wasn't a sack at all. It was just kind of like a bundled form. And you notice the kind of you notice like a bloating, floated form of Skag's character floating. Missing an arm, a leg, and a few other bits of flesh and genitalia.
Oh, God.
Just kind of like stare at it for a sec, check myself.
Check yourself. I'm hard.
No, but I'm probably just gonna, I guess, let it happen, to be completely honest, but. At this point, you said it's like the middle of the night?
Yeah.
I forgot the guy's name. Lyle. Is he still like visible to me at all? Like, is he on the deck anymore?
Yeah, I mean, he's got like a little cell on the front of the deck. He's the only person that's really got any form of cabin. It's not a cabin as such, but he's got like a lower part of the deck that he uses, precisely because he cooks and needs a place for his supplies and everything like that.
Do I have vision on him right now?
Yes.
I'm gonna put my dead or alive mark on him just so that I can keep track of what he does throughout the rest of the night, and I'm not gonna go back to sleep.
That's fine. You watch him for the rest of the night. He just goes back to sleep, and then he kind of wakes up around about 5 and he starts cooking the meal for the crew in the morning. And then he comes around handing out breakfast to everyone as before. It's bacon again.
I'm gonna probably.
Now you've described the body, I'm scared which bit I ate last time. That's
delicious.
Probably I'm gonna eat the eggs and then just kind of like scrape the bacon onto Stretic's plate.
This is a little bit nutty. Yeah. I like this. Like it.
Chewy!
No, you missed out on the delicacy part.
I hold a finger up.
Let me guess. No, actually, no. I don't need to guess because we all know which bit that was, don't we?
Well, there's two of them, and he had one of them, and you had the other one.
I hold up a finger to Belial. I say, Belial, and I hold something up, and I say, you left a toenail in. Sloppy work.
XP, you are a horrible, horrible, horrible man.
Oh, just wait until I'm your DM.
Oh, no!
Dumb.
This is nothing.
I need therapy.
So about later on in the day, the ship, the sort of the free city comes into the distance. You can actually see that it's almost like it's various pillars of cliffs, like small, like they're not huge. They're almost like pillars of rock that jut out of the water, and the city seems to be built on these different pillars, with like bridges and gangplanks and stuff going between. And then as you kind of look through the pillars, you can see the open sea, and you can see there's like a port on the other side. And you can see on this side of the river, there's also like docks areas, and there's various cranes that move cargo up to the upper city. And you can see that the gradually, as you got closer and closer to the free city, the surrounding area went up quite tall as well. So the river's almost running through a valley at this stage. And so the captain goes, ah, we're here. And he sort of says, yes, I suppose we should probably, he calls over Rick. He's like, Rick, have you explained how this works to them? So the captain sits down and says, so Free City then, we do have, we have a pact, an agreement with the Emerald City, Citadel. Obviously, they're our major trade partner and we don't want to accept them too much. So while you don't have a mark from them on, you're free citizens. However, you won't be given a citizenship mark until you've got a sponsor from one of the existing free citizens. And by working for them to pay off your debt to them, they will grant you citizenship, which would then protect you from being enslaved by the Emerald Citadel, provided you followed our rules. Obviously, there are still certain crimes that can result in you know, the revoking of citizenship and the indenture into slavery. But we need to find you a sponsor so that, that can help you out and grant you this citizenships to prevent the Emerald Citadel people from being able to take you back.
I agree.
So how do we go about doing that then?
Yes.
Well, most sponsors are traders, so I do know a few people. There's one in particular I've got in mind, a guy called Holas. He's a particularly fair master. Well, not master.
You better Holas to go find him.
Yeah.
I mean, I could certainly arrange an introduction if that would suit you.
Yes, you see, I have a rather invaluable skill in which I can transplant hands and make people no longer slaves, so I think I will be of use to this man. I think you'll take us.
Yeah. It sounds like the best chance we've got.
Now, where is this man?
So about a couple of hours later, the boat basically pulls into the sort of minor docks area on this side, and the boat kind of shuttles in. The captain pays a small docking fee, and he arranges for the crew to start unloading the cargo that he had previously acquired. And then he kind of comes back, finds you guys, and goes, "Come, we'll go and speak to Holas now." He has a small merchantile. Just over here through the back streets, and you get in this lift, and the lift takes you up to the upper part of the city. And as I mentioned, the whole city's built on these different stone pillars, and they're all interconnected. And you seem to be on a reasonably good sort of part of town at this stage. And there's various shops and traders and stuff like that. And he kind of leads you through this area. And he goes, yes, here's Hollis's merchantile here. And there's quite a large sort of complex with a couple of guards standing outside. And he goes over and he speaks to one of the guards. He goes, yes, we just need to wait 30 minutes and you'll be able to see us. Would you like to explore, or should we just wait here?
Let's see. Well, we hit 22 retweets, actually. That means that we have a viewer decision to do.
I'm on it.
Let's do that now while you guys wait.
Yeah, that's a good idea.
So, yeah. Explain how this works for people in chat. Yeah, then. So folks. Some of you guys are regulars who will understand how this works. Nix and Will have both posted little line.
I lost.
Yeah.
I beat you. Yeah.
My eternal shame.
So what you need to do is bear in mind where the guys
I'm
are.
I'm helping.
So they're in a jungle. They're in a jungle climate. They've just entered the Free City, which is this city that's built on these stone pillars. Now, you guys in chat can come up with a suggestion about what happens next. So post that in chat below the lines that the guys have posted. After a few minutes, we'll stick that into a straw poll and let everyone vote on their favorite suggestion. And then I'll incorporate that either into the immediate scene or to see. to try and bear in mind where the guys are. They've just entered this unusual city that they've not been in before. We know that perhaps they might be being hunted by the Emerald Citizen guys, but bear in mind they have to kill a master. We know also there's this cannibalism stuff going on. Nyx's characters eat parts of Skag's character, as have the others. We've also got this girl who is miraculously being saved from the ritual. So all of these things are things that you might choose to incorporate into your idea.
Yes, good guy, bye. And thanks so much to MTG and D&D for following. Welcome to the adventure, my friend. You're a gentleman and a scholar. Looking forward to hearing those tales. So for us, some ideas, guys. Make them mad, make them wild. Could be to do with an extra body part, which Stritic finds he has. Or that he is, in fact, a rabbit. So, or maybe Mara grows her hair back. Who knows?
Yay! Beautiful red hair. Please.
So, all right, then. Let's wait on Alan, but I guess we'll dive back into it whilst we're waiting for some ideas.
So while we're waiting, you guys, you've got 30 minutes to wait before you go and see Holas at his merchantile. You kind of have a little bit of a wander around the local kind of stalls. So I'd say this is kind of like a middle market sort of area of town. So there's various stalls selling like luxury food stuffs, so much higher quality than you saw in the previous market that you were at in the Emerald Citadel in the lower city. There's like almost like fruit sellers selling like sort of racks of bananas, mangoes, like sort of exotic fruits. There's like a salesperson, like a woman who's got like a almost like a lemonade stand almost, but obviously it's something that's slightly more exotic than that. But you see, there's quite wealthy people going on. And paying like a gold coin for literally a small glass of some sort of refreshing liquid, and there's like clothing merchants, there's weapons merchants, there's various other people kicking around as well. What have you done with the girl at this point, by the way?
Oh yeah, I'd invite her to come with me. She's my test subject.
Right, so we'll assume that both Rick and the girl are with you at the moment, and Rick's obviously, you know. So Nyx and Scarlet, make a perception roll.
And thank you to Priya for following. Welcome to the adventure, my friend. Are you a gentle lady, I'm going to guess, or potentially a gentleman? And Scarlet.
Yay, decent roll.
Nice. 19.
Right, so you guys both noticed that Rick seems to be paying an awful lot of attention to people around him. It's almost as if he's assessing people.
Oh no.
Yes, Rick. Unleash your power. I feel your anger, your hatred.
So mean.
It's just good business.
So
Hold on. Who put into the straw poll about Mara meeting up with her ex? What?
Nobody admit to this.
Oh, come on, tell me. No. Tell me.
It's better if you don't.
I'm gonna go through chat. Hold on. Marvin Hood, it's all your fault. No blame culture, but it's your fault.
I don't know. I rather like the idea of the whole unlimited power. I'm kind of liking that.
Yeah.
I get the feeling it's going to be 10 or 11 with my gut feeling.
Oh.
We'll see. All right, then. So I say.
Flaming's killers linked the straw poll in chat just a few times, so you can't miss it. So, guys, click on that link and vote in the straw poll about which of the suggestions you'd like to see me incorporate into the game. And, Will, where are we on the three followers we need, isn't it?
Let me check here. Yeah, three more followers until a second viewer decision. So, if you want some more madness to happen in the game, folks, all you have to do is hit that follow button. We're here 5 nights a week, 10 shows a week, 150 hours every month. And after this game, we've got the Lost Mine of Phandelver, in which we teach you guys how to play D&D. So if you're a bit of a beginner, then it's a great time to come along. And then in the game after, in fact, at 7 p.m. Eastern, it's not a game, it's an interview with Shanna Germain from Monty Cook Games. They've just released their Kickstarter for Invisible Sun RPG, and she's coming on our show to talk some Invisible Sun and to let you guys know what's going on there. So that's pretty fucking exciting. Also, later in the month, the week after that, we've got John Harper, who created Blades in the Dark. And then the week after that, we've got Ed Greenwood, the creator of Forgotten Realms himself coming on the show, and he's going to be giving away a hardback copy, signed as well by Ed, along with free ebook copies for like PDF stuff. So that's pretty fucking exciting. Looks like we're getting
On the Ed one. So he's actually written it already, because
It's he's got a novel coming out August 31st, which is the day after he's on the show, and then he's got a setting coming out, and then every month after that, Mr. Greenwood is releasing new material, be that a campaign book or a new novel. He's got loads of stuff going out. Super exciting.
Cool. Yes. Definitely one to watch out for. I think you'll probably find there'll be a lot of the GMs entering that contest.
Yes. All right, then. Looks like number 11 has got the most votes. Mara's hair grows back.
We'll give it a few minutes. So, you guys are. So while you're kind of exploring this area, so Nyx, your character, your attention gets drawn by this old woman who's kind of sitting. She's wearing like black, ragged robes, and she's kind of sitting down with a like, little blanket in front of her. With various trinkets on it, and for some reason your character in particular seems drawn to her.
Okay.
As you get closer to her, you kind of notice that she seems to have at one stage in her life she was obviously quite almost a bit like your tribe. Not someone, there's nothing on her tattoo wise that recognizes symbols, you know, but clearly she's got some form of past which may overlap with yours. And as she kind of notices, she kind of looks up, and you see both of her eyes are like white, so she's blind. Mm-hmm. As she kind of looks up, she kind of beckons for you to come closer. So clearly she's able to at least sense your presence. She's like, come, child, come.
I step forward, but cautiously.
And she kind of looks and she goes. And she looks up and she leaps. She goes like, and she's, I smell for soot, char, fire, burns. Burned flesh, brimstone, ash.
I'm afraid so.
Tell me, child, what's happened to you?
We encountered a ship on the way in. It's something was flammable on it. Burst into flames. Got caught.
And she kind of she reaches down and she takes something like a little trinket or some description, like a bangle thing, off her blanket, and she kind of clasps it into your hand.
Okay. Does it actually look like one of like the bracelets that we've seen previously, like for the slaves?
No, this is something much more nomadic.
Okay.
And then you suddenly feel this chill down your spine and something behind you. And as you spin round and then spin back around again, she's gone.
Oh God, not again.
But you feel this chill down your back of your neck as your hair starts to regrow into this prehensile hair, kind of the thing describes, it's now prehensile and can be used as a bonus attack using your bonus action.
Right, okay. Can we make it like red snakes or something?
Yeah, if you want to. Yeah, you can make it, you can customize it as you wish.
Yeah, well, it's going to be red, and snake seems apt because they make a good attack.
It's badass.
So when Nick's character comes back to you, at first you don't recognize her, and then you realize why.
I got my pets.
Nice. Interesting specimen, that one. If ever you need pet care, then you know where to call.
Not you then.
So you guys are ushered into this this kind of low one-story dwelling, and you're taken into kind of quite a luxurious like living room, lounge room almost, and Rick and the captain sort of mentioned it's customary that we break bread with him, and we're safe while we're well in his dwelling, in his home. So don't do anything to embarrass us. And he kind of looks at Will's character as he says
I attack the bread.
So you guys all sit down. There's no chair, so you kind of sit on the floor, basically on these rich carpets that cover the stone floor. And a servant comes in and provides like fruit and water and stuff. The servant's not wearing any bracelet though, so it's clearly not a slave. It's just someone who's paid to do that. And then after a few minutes, this guy comes through, and he's kind of, he actually looks really young. He only looks about sort of 18, maybe if that. He He's wearing really good quality, sort of not silks as such, but just like white cotton, like very high quality cotton clothes. Clearly very good in this climate. You notice he's got like a dagger at his side, and he sits down and says, please help yourselves. As he notices Will's character already halfway through a loaf of bread.
I'm breaking it, look.
I sit down politely and do the sensible thing.
So he turns to the captain, Nathaniel, and goes, "So Nathaniel, what can I do for you then? It's been a while since I've seen you. Do you wish to trade? You seem to have brought a troop of strangers to my home today." And Nathaniel kind of steps up and goes, these people unusually managed to escape from the Citadel prior to the ritual. Although more interestingly, while on our journey, we found this young girl here who had been saved from the ritual somehow. This unusual fellow here," and he kind of points at Will's character, "used some sort of weird magic to interrupt the ritual." And you can kind of see that everyone, the slaves, well, not the slaves, the servants included, seem to sort of like look at Will's character and between the girl and Will's character. And Hollis is like, "Well, that would be most interesting. I wonder if this is repeatable."
"Yes, it is." "Yeah, I can do it as many times as I want, as long as I had a willing host and some space."
And you kind of hear there's like a polite cough, and Rick's character's like, "I would be more than willing to volunteer myself for the procedure if you could find a willing donator to help my friend out here. As you can see, I only have a few weeks left before the ritual impacts myself, so I would be indebted to you if you were to assist in this." And you can see Hollis goes, perhaps. "But first, before I engage in such arcane rituals, I assume you are thus here to request my sponsorship in the Free City."
"Yes, correct.
That is the case, yes."
"Now, obviously, it is, you're clearly capable individuals to escape from the Citadel's slave
clearly
pits before the ritual's even been done on you. But that does obviously pose problems in itself. There may well be people hunting you, for all I know."
"There likely is, yes.
The sponsorship process does make me liable for your actions in the short term as well. But clearly, this is an interesting situation we appear to be in."
"We're clearly trustworthy individuals."
"Perhaps."
I stuff more bread into my mouth and then put some mysteriously into another pocket.
"Perhaps you could prove yourselves to me to be of worth to me. I do have a particular challenging situation at the moment that is distracting my attention from more important matters. If you were able to assist me in this matter, then I would be more than happy to..."
"I would consider it."
"We would consider it."
"Well, these ones aren't very useful to you, honestly, are they?"
Do you know anything about claims?" He kind of looks at you.
"Oh, yes, legal forms and the like."
"You know about legal forms?"
"Well, yes, I've had many injuries at work which weren't my fault."
"Right, okay, moving on.
People sometimes die from the transplants, and it's totally not my fault."
"Yeah, of course not."
"So, Arsenal, get on. We have this concept of claim tokens. So, as you know, we are but visitors to this ancient world, and there are many riches underneath the jungle foliage for those who are willing to go out and venture it. Now, such expeditions are not cheap. So, the free citizens, the lords of the free city, have come up with this this concept of claim markers. So when you put down a claim marker, no one else may interfere with that claim for a period of 7 days. And it gives the original finder of the expedition, you know, the funder of it, a chance to have first picks of the spoils before the scavengers and the ravagers of the rest of the people descend on the ruins and pillage it for their own benefits. Now, I myself had sponsored such an expedition. And Creel, and he kind of calls over a guy who's been waiting at the back that you hadn't really noticed before. Creel is one of my explorers, and we'd sent out an expedition, and unfortunately, goblins pesky little brats have invaded the expedition we were scavenging.
What is a goblin?
A little green thing.
Fun to kill. If it's fun to kill, I'm sure you could ransack some of its body parts.
And he sort of like goes, and so they'd they've invaded this claim site and taken prisoner some of my people who do the excavations and the collecting side. If you were to travel with Creel and free my people and help them carry back the spoils, dispatching the goblins before we run out of time, then I would be happy to sponsor you.
Sounds easy enough. I'm all for it.
Very well. We will see these goblins, and I wish to study their anatomy. However, I have one condition. When we get the bodies of the goblins, they belong to me.
Welcome.
He's fine. I have no issues with that.
Excellent. It's a deal. And then I go.
And Rick leans over to you and goes, no, I don't want a goblin hand. Human hand.
You might not have much of a choice.
You'll get what you're given. And
see?
And thanks so much to Graydons for following. Welcome to the adventure, my friend. You're a gentleman and a scholar. Just two followers away now, guys.
So the girl, Sarah, and Rick and the captain kind of stay in the hospitality of the Horas for the time being. You guys go away into another area where Creole has kind of got a map laid out. He says, here's the site, and it's about a day's travel through the jungle. It's not particularly difficult to get to, though. We were quite lucky to discover it, to be honest. It's been overlooked by many other expeditions. We can provide you with any armor or weapons that you need if you need to replenish your stocks. But we should probably be heading out shortly. The quicker we get there, the more time we'll have to handle the situation before other scavengers and may descend on the claim.
Very well, we will see to it immediately.
So again, you can replace, if you're missing any items from your original character sheet, Creel can happily replace them with items from his stash.
It'd be quite good, actually.
He also provides you, actually no, he doesn't, I'll cover that later.
I need magic
he provides you with you know, water skins and food, etc. And, okay. And he basically mentions that most of the Holas's crew are out at the site, so it'll be just him traveling with you guys to try and scope out the site and clear it of goblins.
I want some, just like, I mean, this doesn't actually mean anything in terms of the game, but Stretic would ask for some like arcane ingredients, and not necessarily arcane, just like weird shit which he uses for arcane ingredients.
Yeah, so roll a d10.
Sure.
And he gets you that many of your weird arcane ingredients.
Three weird shits. Okay.
And you may specify what that number is to the party.
Okay. I'll keep the weird bits to myself for now.
Of course. I'd ask him for something sensible, like a hand axe and a javelin would be nice.
Yeah, so javelins are no problem at all. Neither is a hand axe. They've got things like machetes and stuff like that as well. Because obviously you're going into a jungle terrain, so he equips the more physical of you guys with machetes to help cut down the vines and things like that on the route.
Mm-hmm.
Is there anything you guys want to do before you head out?
I'm good to go straight away. I'm impatient.
Yeah,
I'm good to go.
Yeah,
I'm set.
So you guys head out, basically, and he mentions there's a campsite that you can use that if we hurry, we should be able to make it there before it gets too late. We used that on the way out, so it's quite a well-known campsite. It's a nice, safe little alcove. But halfway through the journey, though, he stops and he spots something in the distance, and he goes away, and he goes, come here, follow me. And he goes up to this like purple flower, which is hanging from a tree. And he takes out, he opens his pouch at the side and he takes it out and he milks this flower into these little glass vials. He manages to get six vials worth. He takes three of them himself, but he hands each of you guys one of these vials. And basically the vial is equivalent to a D10 healing potion. Mm-hmm. Now, for those of you who have nature, you can use nature to try and support these plants in future if you wanted to repeat the exercise he just did.
Let's have a look. Do I have nature? I have nature! Yay! Okay.
Sorry, Will.
I don't have nature. What have any of my skills ticked? Why am I such an idiot? I don't know.
I was going to say, you wouldn't have nature because you defile nature, surely.
Well, I also study it so that I can defy it. But yeah, I don't have it.
Mm.
So about midway through, so about a couple of hours later, you arrive at this campsite that they've clearly used before. I have a map for this one, actually. I will drag you to
the map. Oh boy. I have an overlay which isn't ready for this one.
Yeah. I haven't decided if anything's going to happen or not yet, so just to kind of show you the where you are, effectively. So you're in this this sort of old bit of ruins, and there's like a burnt out fire pit. And there's your characters are kind of kicking around here. There's some arrows and stuff from previous expeditions.
Nice.
All right, so I say, how does one track a goblin? I've never met one of these creatures before, and
If they're anything like in my world, they usually find us.
They're not particularly stealthy. They tend to be noisy, like childlike, bratish.
Oh, good.
So normally, it's not particularly difficult. We were taken by surprise. There was a large number of them. We did manage to fell several of them, though.
This is good news. So,
what do you have in mind to do with these bodies of goblins?
I've told you once. I'll tell you again. Don't ask questions that you don't want the answer.
You don't want to know the answer to. Yeah,
that is right.
Just gonna make a big amalgamation.
Mega
goblin.
I look at. How did you find out about my flesh golem? And I scurry away.
Good grief.
Plotting.
Scurries away to go be one with the goblins.
They are my people.
Did you guys want to do anything overnight?
Apart from stay as far away from Stretic as possible, no, I'm fine.
Are you taking watches?
I'll take watch.
Well, to make sure it doesn't steal our hands.
And thanks to Pum Rider for following.
Yeah.
Welcome, Pum Rider. You're a gentleman and a scholar. You ride them pumps, boy.
So Creel, I mean, Creel's happy to take one watch.
I'll take another one then.
I'll take your watch. All right.
So yeah, you have my watch, just not my hands.
So all four of you are basically taking watches. So basically,
I take his actual watch.
Let's just do this.
Marvin's getting wrecked in his dungeon today. We're just like enabling him, though, just to watch him fail over and over.
So, Scott,
I'm not going dungeoning.
Scott, make a perception test, please.
Boy, oh boy, my favourite.
Oh boy.
Not terrible.
You kind of notice something shadowy at the edge of the forest, kind of stalking around a little bit. Now, at the moment, it's not come any closer to you. And obviously there is a fire in the pit at the moment. It's burning down a little bit though, but you do kind of notice something like low down to the ground, but quite sort of bulky, stalking around a little bit.
I'm just going to keep my eye on it for now and see if it does anything.
So we'll assume your next watch, the next watch after you then is Nyx.
Yeah.
So it gets to the end of your watch, and Nick's taking over.
I'm gonna let her know that I did see something stalking around.
So you don't see anything, Nick, when you take over?
See. Oh, a 7, yeah. That's not good. We all die.
Can I just, like, during my watch, since I'm not really paying attention to what's going on outside, can I actually have a look at that bracelet that I was handed?
Yep. It just looks like almost like a African sort of tribal bracelet.
Nothing special about it that I know of.
It seemed to your hair, the reaction your hair had seemed to happen at the same time you were given the bracelet.
Anything happen if I put on the bracelet?
Well, you're already wearing it.
Oh, okay then. I presumed I was carrying it, but so okay, fine. I'm wearing it. It's fine. Yeah,
it's on your head.
The snakes are wearing it.
I guess I'll take the next one.
Okay, yeah, that's alright then.
Nothing
terrible
happens.
Cool, right, you wake up in the morning, everything's fine.
Oh, okay. Alright, cool.
Unfortunately, without Bilal the chef here, the breakfast is a cold bread and cheese breakfast.
Ah,
Those are two of my favorite things.
Ditto.
Yuck.
Just live off bread and cheese, I'd be fine.
Disgusting.
What, no meat?
No blood.
So, after a couple of hours trekking through the jungle, you come upon the edge of these ruins that the goblins are apparently in. So, kind of Creel gestures for you to kind of stop quietly, and you guys are looking on the over on these ruins. Okay. Right, Will.
Yes.
I'm going to move the guys to a map.
Oh my god.
I don't know if you want to set up a map view or leave it in the little view. Large map.
A large map.
Good brief it is, isn't it?
Let's go through.
Oh, there we are. Are we? Yes, yeah, yes,
you
we
guys
are.
Right down the bottom of it.
Good grief.
Will, I will give you control of the camera icon as well.
Sure.
You've really done your work today, haven't you?
That's Nyx. All right.
The camera icon is just above. I'll just delete Sky character since he's been eaten. The camera icon is just above your character at the moment, Will.
Thank you.
So meanwhile, while Will's setting that up, I will do Will's normal on the hour spiel for everyone.
Thank you.
So coming up after this show in an hour's time, we have the Lost Mines of Phandelver, which is what comes from the D&D starter set for 5th edition. So if you are new to the channel and you are maybe following along a little bit but not quite sure how all things are working, what you'll find is that particular show tends to take things at a slightly slower pace, so people have a bit more time to understand the rules. So we explain things a little bit more to you. You can ask some questions in chat if you've got any questions, and the mods will help out, etc. So it's well worth tuning in for that one. And then following on from that, as a special edition tonight, Will has got an interview with Montico Games.
Shannon Germain is her name.
Yeah. So Montico Games have just brought out a Kickstarter for something called Invisible Sun, which you can find on Kickstarter. It seems to be quite a premium product. So they seem to be concentrating a lot on the quality of the item and the quality of what you get in that pack. Obviously there's various ways that you can interact with the show. So you can make donations. There's a list of donations that you can make below. So you can donate everything from like £1 or £3 just to either aid or hinder the players with nat ones, crits, etc. You can donate £5 if you want them to roll on the wild magic table, or if you want to introduce a minor creature into the encounter with the players. So that would maybe be something like a tiger or a jaguar or a goblin or something like that.
Dragon.
Or you can do a little bit more if you want a boss level encounter, so maybe a
dragon.
You want to fight a dragon.
Obviously, all of those donations support the channel, so obviously people like Will have to live off this channel effectively. Although Encounter is now partnered, it is they do put an awful lot of time into keeping this channel running so we can enjoy it. So please do support them, and if you can't afford to support them, just follow them and help out on things like retweeting on Twitter, etc.
Yeah, awesome stuff. All right, I have a map.
Yeah, it looks like the map's not fully
loaded
with this stuff. So
you want to tell the guys in chat how you come up with your maps and stuff?
Yeah, so these particular maps are from Heroic Maps, which is one of the sort of affiliate sponsors of the channel. So yeah, they provide a really good, nice set of maps. Will, you may want to zoom down to right at the bottom of the map where the player characters are.
Okay, yeah, bottom down here. All right, I see it.
Cool.
That's better.
So this, we're using Roll20, folks. So if you haven't seen Roll20 before, you can configure something called dynamic lighting, which appears to be partially working, which basically means you can attach the tokens that the guys have got down here, and you can configure lighting around those tokens.
Nice. Perfect.
So that's pretty good.
I'm all set.
So we will roll initiative once for the whole encounter. So if you guys want to roll your initiative, I will make a note of that. We'll set that order up, and we'll just maintain that order throughout the whole encounter.
It's going to be terrible, isn't it? Oh, 12, not too bad.
Initiative. 21.
Show off.
21. Blackjack.
I'm trying, but it actually isn't rolling.
No, it's not good. You just have to click on the initiative button on your card sheet, probably.
Yeah, that's what I'm doing.
You have to click on your token, then click on it.
That's it. Is clicked on here. You know what? Let me not be clicking on it.
Sure.
Oh, now it goes.
Yeah.
And you're a show off as well.
Maybe I've not set your token up yet for you since it is set to you. Oh. Right, oh cool, so 22. 21.
I'm going to go first.
12.
And Creel goes after you.
Creel.
So first up we have Scarlet, then Will. So guys, basically you kind of stealth up a little bit, and Creel's like, here's the ruins. It doesn't look like they've left any guards outside. Typical goblins. Lax. Should we sneak in? How do you want to play this?
Do we really have to sneak? I'm all for just like going in there, chopping their heads off, pulling it down.
I say we sneak at first, and then when we immediately fail, we attack.
Here.
Fine.
I'll go in. I'll take a look around, and I'll signal you to follow after me.
Right, cool. So, Scarlet, do you want to make a stealth roll, please?
Let me do that. I'm going to turn my bedroom light on. I can't see a freaking thing. Oh, man.
Damn.
That one.
Right, so I'm going to move your character for you. So, Will, you can follow on where he gets to.
Yeah. What's up, Brian? How's it going, buddy?
You stealth up to here, basically. You're getting that one. You're basically busy paying attention to the surroundings, and it is a little bit dark here, and you're keeping an eye out for goblins. And just as you kind of get to where you are, you notice there's this blood on the floor, and then all of a sudden you hear this. There's this blade, this like razor sharp metal blade, spins up out of the floor and slices along towards you. Now, because you've got a natural one, you are going to be hit by it, but I will give you a dex save to take half damage. So I will roll the damage first before you roll the dex save. That way we'll know.
Whoops.
Oh, well.
This is Indiana Jones as all hell.
Yeah.
I'm getting flashbacks to a halfling character that I played a while back.
The penitent man. Gee. The penitent man kneels.
Kneels!
So it does that significant amount of damage. However, you do make your dex save, so you only take half of that.
Thank God.
Whoa, 20.
So you guys basically hear this kind of like sort of this really loud sort of metal screeching noise, and then a sort of yelp from
that was the Scott's immediate character. Failure I spoke about earlier. Ah, I'm glad, Peerless, you are muted, Nyx. I shall.
Yeah, you muted me.
Yes,
because I'm a noisy bugger. I know. yeah, I rush over. It's like, what's going on? What's the noise?
Well, you go inside. Traps. As well, I guess.
You can see there's blood all over the floor at the point of the tomb where.
Excellent work.
It does look like there's. You can see other sort of more dried on blood, maybe blood from goblins, and you see Creel goes, "Oh shit! Sorry, forgot to tell you about that."
Oh, useful.
That would have been good to know.
I look at Scar's character. So, are you hurt?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, just out of character. How badly hurt is Alex?
He's quite badly hurt.
You can see, like, on his leg.
Yeah, his leg's got a huge gash out of it, and his blood pouring down.
Yeah, a chunk of his like lower leg below the knee, the muscle is just chunked, like slightly hanging off.
Yeah, so you see the Creel go, My fault. Here, let me give you an extra one of these. And he rummages around in his pack for one of these glass vials, and he gives you one of those.
Yeah, I'm going to use it immediately.
Yeah. So I think I said they were D10, didn't I? So they're a little D10. Yeah. And you've obviously got your own one as well if you want to take two.
Oh!
Damn.
Talk about bad luck.
You have betrayed Shiva.
What I'm going to do is I've got all my furs. And-
yeah. So Scarlet, think about this. So basically, you've been given this strange potion that you don't really know is necessarily a healing potion or not. And you drink it, and it has very, very, very little effect. But that's what you're thinking at the moment. You're thinking, this is shit.
Okay, can I do like some basic medicine on him just to try and stop the bleeding in his leg?
You can do. It won't. I mean, it'll maybe
it's,
heal.
It's more for more for RP.
I'll tell you what. I'll let you have a D4 heal if you make a DC 10 medicine check. However, if you you just made
just
it. I was gonna say if you botched it. Yeah, you could take his leg off.
It's gonna be a one for this, isn't it?
That's all you can get from medicine. Anything else has to be magical healing or potions from now on. So you've had your kind of medicine usage. So you
my medicine skill on a 10 was better than the freaking potion was.
Yeah.
Pleased with that. Very pleased.
Excellent. So you guys, I'm just going to move you. If you move you guys all up, so you're all standing next to this position.
Sure. We get there in a second. Oh my god, there's a new track on called Lost Mine. This sounds perfect.
We can't hear any of it.
I know.
It's not fair.
It's not for you, okay, Rach?
Oh, I'm sorry.
To be fair, there is. I am planning to introduce audio, and the way I'm going to do it is I'm going to use it on the iPad to a Bluetooth speaker that will sit below the mic.
Oh, that's cool.
So you guys will get to hear certain stuff in the future.
Not a bad idea. Yeah.
See, Will? XP thinks I'm special enough.
Yeah, well, if you
it's got nothing to say to that, really. I mean,
I was going to say, it's the first time anyone back chatted me. It's like, I found his mute button.
Right, so back to the top of the round then. So I think let's be nasty about this then. So Scarlet, now that you've been injured, let's move you down the initiative track a little bit and put you below Will.
That's fair.
So you're kind of hobbling a little bit. So we'll call your initiative just above between Will and Nyx's character. So Will, you're now first in the initiative order. What do you want to do?
Okay, so he looks... it's pretty injured, so I take a step forward and I say, "The shadows hold no fears for me," and begin to kind of step forward. But I want to do it kind of slowly. I see there's blood up here, so I'm looking for traps along the way.
Kind of are we going to have to spell out somebody's name by stepping on carved stone tiles as well? I mean, how far is this going to go, Indiana style?
Begins with an I.
You must choose wisely.
You chose poorly.
Face starts to melt like wax. Let's face it, if anybody's face is going to melt like wax, it's going to be Stratix, isn't it? I mean...
Nah, the goblet doesn't make your face melt. That was the covenant of the whatever the hell. Goblet makes
Oh, you know yourself.
It makes it... I don't remember the name, but I remember what shit does. The goblet makes you age incredibly fast so that it you pretty much die immediately.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, Will, your character's walked forward a little bit. You see... there doesn't appear to be any traps, and Creel does mention that they got further into the tomb than this and there wasn't any other traps.
Okay, so I go bravely, boldly step forward.
Yeah, because we judge your memory.
Right. And are you stealthing, Will, or are you just kind of strolling up this?
I mean, I guess a stretic stroll is probably a little stealthy. He kind of shuffles. So
make a stealth roll?
It's more like a stretic shuffle, I suppose. Stealth is 7.
The hit new dance craze.
Yeah, right.
That's not enough to beat their passive reception. So I'm just going to move everyone up. So basically, you get quite far up to here. Just going to grab you guys.
Okay.
Okay.
So what you notice here is that the corridor almost appears to drop into like a pit. So basically, the room ahead of you is actually on the floor below.
Ah, okay.
So you see what I mean? So basically, there's almost like a sort of drop into this room below, and then the corridor continues to the other side. So obviously, there may have been a corridor at some point. Oh, we've got a donation.
What donation? What?
Some reason I got 2 Twitch alerts on. Fate to Crimson Phoenix donates £5 and says, "Kalimar demands blood. A living stone sculpture of a centaur suddenly comes around from..." Let me read the rest of that. Suddenly, comes around from the corner from a hidden room. Someone stepped on a loose stone that sets off the trap. Must have been Will. Thanks, man. Thank you, Brian.
So good. Now we have to fight a stone centaur.
Yeah, it's all good.
Of course we do. Lovely.
Thank you, Crimson Phoenix. We give you that going from. What's up, Griffin? Good to see you, my friend. How's it going today, dude?
Also, is the stream frozen for anyone else, or is it just me?
Just you.
Just you.
Cool, cool.
So basically, just as you're kind of getting to this point and see this, you hear this kind of like sort of clicking noise. Aesthetic sort of goes whoops, and then there's this roar from below, and this stone centaur jumps up from the room below and lands in front of you. You guys are taken by surprise, so he gets an attack at one of you.
Oh
Oh, he could have been a friendly centaur. We got a friendly bear last session.
A friend's tour.
So, one to four, basically. So one is Will, two is Nyx, three is Scarlet, four is Creel.
That's
Will. So he jumps up, basically, and he thrusts this stone spear at Will's character.
Ow!
Should we see Will?
AC! I think, like, four, man,
is this where he's, is this how he's going to find out what plumb the depths actually means?
That's a great stretch.
Oh, he fails.
My AC is 13 for posterity.
So basically, he lunges forward towards you and kind of misses, and he actually collapses to his knees a little bit, and one of his legs, one of his stone legs, like fractures as it hits the floor.
Wow!
And collapses, but he's still obviously more than capable, and then he has his second attack against.
Technically, we're all half centaur.
Creel,
stop.
I mean, old Will's down here.
And he hits. So basically, he thrusts the spear at. He sort of swings around and stabs the spear at Creel.
Oh, that's missing spear.
We can't hear it. We don't know.
Man, I wish it had.
So Creel yelps out. Basically, this stone spear crashes into him. So now, top of the round, Will, your character.
I'm going to. Okay, let me look at my sheet real quick because I haven't played this game in a while, and I'm a wizard, so I'm shit playing spellcasters. Okay, so my.
Don't blame you.
My spell that I'm going to cast, I have everything which is like a non-fucking useful one. I'm going to do Ray of Frost.
Mm-hmm.
I send out my hand for two nat ones.
Oh, wow.
It backfires and you
actually, is Ray of Frost one you have to roll to hit?
Let me actually check. Let's see here.
It might not be.
We're going to follow the rules to the book.
Ray of Frost. It doesn't actually. A frigid beam of blue white, like, make a ranged spell attack, yeah.
Yep. So basically, you miss. Well, no, actually, you don't, sorry. You let out this ray of frost, and basically, this bright blue ray fires out from Will. And the centaur sort of moves his hand around, and this glowing bronze shield. And the ray hits the shield and bounces off, hitting one of you two.
Sorry!
So Will, roll a 1d2. If it's a 1, it's Scarlet. If it's a 2, it's Nyx.
Good.
You're gonna die.
Stuff. Roll 1d2. 2.
Will!
Sorry!
Roll damage, please.
My B.
I feel like in his spare time, Stretic just browses the internet trying to stay hip and cool with all the neat kid lingo.
I get down
that's
in the lingo.
So we'll roll damage for that Ray of Frost?
Sure thing. My Ray of Frost deals only one damage. One damage to you.
You throw an ice cube at me.
Yeah. Deadly. he's lucky it didn't hit him.
So you basically feel this refreshing, cooling breeze.
Yes, that's quite nice. It's a bit of a hot day in here as well.
So it's not plus spell mod or anything like that, Will. It's just 1d.
Let me check it. I might have put it in wrong. But Ray of Frost. Sure? Yeah. I think probably, let's see. 1d8 cold damage, yep. Just 1d8.
Yeah, you cool.
That's fine. I'll take a nice cool breeze. It's a bit chilly, but you know, I can cope with that.
Actually, what is the roll looks a little bit weird for that.
It does look a little weird.
It doesn't it? I think it's because it's done through
the macros.
The macro stuff. I think it is correct.
Oh, we'll assume it worked out anyway.
Yeah.
Right, so Will, that was your action. So next up we have Scarlet.
Yay, it's time for crossbows. I got to shoot a bunch of them. Here's the first one. Doubt that a 12 is enough.
No, 12 is not enough because this guy basically being made out of stone, his armor class is quite high.
And maybe the second one? Nope.
Nope. Next up we have Nyx. And bear in mind you have your bonus attack with your hair.
Yeah, have we actually decided how much damage my hair gets to do?
My guess would be either a D6 or a D4.
It'll be a D4. It'll be a D4 with no bonus. So,
bonus,
it's a free bonus attack basically using your bonus action, so it would use it.
Let's have a look then. Okay, reckless attack, raging, because awesomeness, And I'm going to swing my great axe at him.
Yeah.
13.
Nope. Your axe chinks off his stone form.
Damn.
And my hair will snap at him.
All your hair?
God damn it, Bran.
All my hair.
So you do get your you do get your strength bonus to the attack roll with your hair, just not the damage.
Okay, so it's plus 3 then. I'll set up the macro in a minute.
Yeah, so
21.
Yeah, you hit with your hair.
My axe didn't hit, but my hair did.
Roll damage, so
D4. With pleasure. Boop. 3 points.
You do 3 points of damage to this stone form. So Creel basically smashes at it with his machete.
He's machete.
Machete.
And he hits as well.
Ooh.
Ooh. Very
nice.
Boy.
And does 7 points of damage, better than you guys have done.
Yeah. Creel of the carry.
However, it is now the centaur's go. So the centaur's first attack is going to be on
D4. Me. It's me.
One. Will.
Again? Jeez.
Sounds you right for attacking me.
He misses. Again, he
damn,
fails.
Damn, crit fail. That's the second crit fail.
This centaur sucks at his job.
Yeah.
Yeah. We'll assume he's at disadvantage to his next attack because of that. His next attack is against 3, which is on my screen, Scarlet.
Oh, good.
Oh, Harry. Boy. Welcome back, Annie. How's the
walk? Elven enough to hit you.
No, it is not.
Right, so his spear basically just swipes over your head as you duck. Top of the round, we have Will.
Oh, well, that was...
I thought that we were going to go for the 15 to hit.
I'm going to chill touch. Chill touch is another nat 1, really? God damn.
We're going through the gnats today, aren't we?
It's 1d8 necrotic damage and can't regain hit points until the start of next turn.
So given 12 touch is actually a touch 1, we won't have that fumble onto someone else. We'll just assume it doesn't work.
Alright, cool. That's my turn. I'm the most useless.
It's crossbow time.
Actually, just a second, Will. Roll D percentile. If you get below 30, if I remember correctly, someone last time had this thing that if you roll below 30, you hit yourself. Or you can touch...
You actually control one of his limbs.
Yeah, I control one of your limbs.
Oh, yeah.
That's right.
39, yeah.
So you're okay.
Oh,
otherwise, you would have been chill touching yourself.
If I had a dollar for every chill toucher.
Next time we have Scarlet.
Bang!
Hey, that's some rolls.
Bang!
No, that's not. So you do 9 points of damage to it. You basically, the arrow kind of shoots into its shoulder and a chunk of the stone basically gets knocked out as the arrow knocks out past it.
Nice.
Scarlet, your imagination amazes me. Light crossbow, other light crossbow.
Hell yeah. Don't want to get him confused.
Nick's your character.
My character, great axe. 20.
What'd you get advantage? Yes, that is a hit.
And that's 8 damage. And I will use my snake hair.
No, you miss.
No!
Right.
So the centaur goes. Centaur's definitely down on its luck now. So it's going to roll. First attack is against 1, 2, Scarlet. I'll just roll the second. See who the second attack's going to be at the same time. Second attack's going to be against Nyx. So first attack.
In before that one.
Is 15. Is that enough to hit you?
Oh no.
Oh baby.
My AC is stupidly high because of one of the features of this class.
16, is that enough to hit you next?
16, yeah.
Right. However, it's given it's got a stone spear rather than an actual spear, it does count as bludgeoning damage. So if you've got resistance to that while you're...
Resistance to bludgeoning, yeah, so I take half.
Yeah.
And the damage.
So you take 2 points of damage.
Lovely.
This centaur is awful at his job.
I'm not complaining.
Top of the round, Will. Who would you like to hit this time in the party?
Well, that's a good question.
Who are you going to throw ice cubes at this time?
Yeah.
It's just a shame that Will doesn't have things like Fireball, isn't it? Yeah. I'll be tempted to give him it just so I can take the party out.
Aww.
Chill touch for a nat 20, bringing it back.
Oh.
12 damage.
Yeah, so you basically kill it. You reach.
Don't call it a comeback.
Well, actually, so what happens is Will reaches forward and grasps this stone centaur, and you can see the magic surge through Will's body down his hand, and the stone shrinks away from the centaur. And what you suddenly realize is this centaur is actually one of the slaves that's been changed into stone form in the past.
Oh no!
And what's lying in front of you at the end is this dead human centaur.
Oh.
Oh.
I shrug. Meh. It happens.
So Will,
is the sphere?
So Will, roll a. Well, let's just assume Will. Your character's never seen a centaur before. So lying in front of you is a human corpse of a half man, half horse.
Okay, I immediately begin to investigate. Obviously.
Yeah. So as you start to investigate this, you guys hear this noise from opposite you guys. So if you scroll up and look opposite you.
Let me guess.
So what we can do is two goblins with short bows.
Yes.
Oh boy.
Goddamn.
Two goblins with short bows.
Yay. What is that creature?
Is going to shoot at two, which is next.
Oh.
Please, no weirdo this evening.
Three, which is Scarlet. First one at Nyx. These guys are just goblins, so 9's probably a miss.
That's a miss, yeah.
12 will be a miss against Scarlet as well. So basically as you're kind of looking at this and realizing what happened, these little arrows, you know, sort of tiny little goblin arrows start pinking across the gap towards you. Top of the round.
Who's top of the round? That'll be Will, wouldn't it?
Right.
Yeah, we'll go back to the top of the round. No, actually, we'll assume Will skips it because he's still looking at the human, so
yeah,
we'll go to
him.
That means it's me. Alright. I'm gonna do one shot at each of them.
Yep.
Not gonna hit.
Nope. That's a. we'll let you away with it.
I've got a +7 on it, so like. Even if it's a nat one. Alright, second one.
No. So basically, you ineffectively fire two crossbow bolts back across this sort of gap of this room.
They're too far away.
Nyx, your character.
I'm gonna jump down and dash towards them.
Right, so you jump down. So that's gonna be athletics or acrobatics, your choice. You are jumping down like 10 feet here.
Athletic. 18.
Yeah, you're fine.
Nice.
Each square is obviously 5 feet of movement.
Yeah, I think with dash I get to move 60, so I was
there. According to the ruler, every square is only half of 5 feet, so it's only 2.5.
Yeah, I know.
Actually, sorry, he's right, because I doubled over the squares in this one to make the...
Oh!
Bigger.
Okay, so hold on. 5, 10,
15.
Good grief, I've grown huge!
Oh, I was worried we were fighting mega goblins!
The mega goblin.
10, 15, 20,
okay.
25, 30.
Nice.
I'll just dash up to here. There we go.
Right, guys. Obviously, you're gonna have to make a climb roll to get up there.
Athletics. Or does it have to be acrobatics?
Athletics this time. Is it as a climb roll?
10.
There's vines and stuff. 10's enough for you to basically. So you basically start across this room and clamber up the other side to where the goblins are.
Yeah, I'm just roaring with anger.
Top of the round. Oh, so the goblins next then. So the goblins are going to attack you since you're closest to it than that.
Bring it.
So.
I take half damage, I believe.
Is missed. Next one is 12. Is 12 enough to hit?
That just hits.
Right. And this is piercing damage, remember. So are you.
This is half, resistance.
Right, so they only do see the short bow, so it'll be D6.
So hang on, your AC is 12?
When I rolled my character, my con has only got a +2. And I don't have any armor.
And figure two, supporter for following. Me. Welcome to the event, my friend. You're a gentleman and a scholar.
Right, yeah. So you take 2 points of damage, then half. So
I've taken 2 points. My character is strong, but not particularly when she's taking damage.
And we have a donation in from Crimson Phoenix who donates £5 and says, because Scarlet was complaining that the centaur wasn't doing his job earlier, a stone griffin comes out from behind to attack. Kalimar is not amused.
What have I done?
You've angered Shiva.
See, Scar, this is why we don't like you.
Kalimar. Kalimar. Dear God.
Scarlet, so I'll get to that in a second. Top of the round, though, Scarlet, it is your go. Oh, no, sorry, so Will's go first.
Yeah, in that case, I'm going to head up here. And I'm going to do another one of those. Another one of those whole thingies. Oh, fuck, not that. That one. Yeah, 17.
There it is.
For 4 necrotic damage on this guy here. Oh, not Chilled Touch. It was the other one.
Ranged one.
Yeah, the ranged dude. Rare Frost.
Cool. You do a substantial amount of damage to him, but he's still up.
Okay, my turn done. That's all I can do.
So, Scarlet, your guy.
Alright. This time, I'm going to see if I can just focus down on one of them, go for the guy on the left there. Shot one. And shot two. I'm assuming at least the second one's going to hit. That's a big bird.
What the fuck? They said it comes out from behind, so it could be coming up behind.
Who bet Stretix going to take the wings?
Scarlet here, if you wanted.
Oh, boy. Oh, goody.
The Punish.
It's got horns.
Hello.
That's a big bird.
Hello, my lady.
attracted by the noise of combat going on inside the this bird has decided it's hungry and it's swept into the cavern and towards you guys.
God.
This happens after your go, Scarlet. So sorry, what were you doing?
I fired both shots at the guy on the left.
You hit with both, so the guy on the left is dead now. That's
nice.
All
as well.
And then the bird goes next. So this bird has 3 attacks. Given it
Oh, Jesus.
Good grief. TPK, here we go.
First attack is a 9, so that misses you. Next attack is a 10.
That's going to hit.
And a 19.
Oh, God. Okay, so I'm going to hit by 2 of them.
Right, thank you to
Mr. Damage Knight
Ninja for following. Welcome, Boon, to the adventure. You're a gentle ninja and a scholar. About to have a viewer decision. I'll let David get the endless turn and we can do one of those.
Cool. So there's 14 points of damage to you.
Oh, boy.
As its claws rake down your back, basically. Oh,
damn. Got that a brand.
That puts me down.
And, are you down?
I'm down.
Kalimar is not amused. Wow.
I might not be that tanky, but my AC is ridiculous.
Right, here we go.
So next up we have Nick. So you hit you're down and you hear this squawking and swooping noise from behind, but you're too busy occupied by the goblin in front of you at the moment.
Yeah, I'll finish off the goblin in front of me first. Da-da-da-da-da. 23.
Yeah, you do 4 points of damage to the goblin in front of you and slice into it.
And my hair goes snappy snap. 22 again.
Your hair wraps around its neck, and you hear this snapping noise as the goblin's neck is snapped.
Ooh.
And the hair doesn't seem to want to let go of the goblin.
Oh, typical.
You have a flail now. Boost the damage to 1d6 if it's not going to let go, please.
So, Will, do you want to do the viewer's decision call?
Yeah, let's do that. So, guys, we're in a bit of a pickle here. We've got down here, good old Alex is down fighting a giant griffin, and I'm in the center here whilst Rach has killed this goblin. So we've got big old griffin, we're in a temple, so you guys decide what happens next. Throw out your ideas under this line here in the chat. As some ideas that something could happen to the party. It could be another encounter, it could be a trap, it could be just something which happens to one of our characters. Throw out one of the ideas that you have in your brain hole and we'll put it into a straw poll. The most popular decision will happen. We'll have another one of 30 followers and another one in a few retweets time. So get following, retweeting if you haven't already. And throw out your ideas.
Bring it. Bring the ideas.
Yes. Kalimar confirmed.
Right, so let's do, we'll do one round of combat and then we will take the decisions. So if you guys can get those decisions in quickly, because we obviously only have about 20 minutes left of the session.
Indeed.
So bear that in mind, if you want to end the session on the cliffhanger, we have one more session of the Emerald Citadel, because some of the guys are having to take sabbaticals. Obviously Skaggs are taking a bit of a time off, and Scarlet is moving into college digs will be similar. So we'll have one more session next week. So maybe you can influence what's going to happen in that session as well, if you want to bring up to that.
I feel like I'm missing out on something. All these people are moving houses, and I'm just going, no. Just no.
I'm not moving houses. I'm just going to college to get an edumacation.
And thanks to Jackie69 for following. Welcome, my friend, to the adventure. You're a gentleman and a scholar. So he takes one damage on a 19, and his speed is reduced by 10 feet until the start of my next turn.
And is this against the Griffin?
Griffin, yeah.
Yeah, which you can see because it's a large target.
It's kind of up there.
Oh, by the way, attacks against the Griffin have advantage because it's a large creature.
In that case, then, it's a nat 20. I deal 5 damage.
Oh, cool. Well, so you do 5 damage against the Griffin.
Fuck yeah.
Next up, we have Scarlet's character. Make your death save, please.
Oh, boy. Oh, boy. Finds the death save button. Oh no.
Oh, that's a nat 1!
The bonus one!
Oh, that's 2 failures immediately.
Go get some ELP rips.
Oh boy. I'm seeing the light of my favorite saloon in the distance.
So next up we have Nyx's character.
Okay. Let's have a look at the map.
So actually, technically, it's the Griffin next.
Go for it.
I am going to roll. Griffin's
how evil do you feel?
Well, it's a predatory bird that's come in here for food.
I can see where this is going.
So I'm going to roll a d20. If it's 5 or under, it makes one attack against your body. No.
Oh.
It attacks Creel instead.
Oh, boy.
Creel can take it. He's an NPC.
2 hits against Creel.
He's dead. It's going to scrape the blubber right off of him.
Yeah, he's dead. Because he'd already taken damage before from the centaur. So you hear this scream as Creel's character basically dies.
Oh, Creel dies, fuck.
Oh.
Oh man, rest in pepperonis.
So guys, the straw poll is up. I hope you've got some stuff in there that can save the
pot. Oh, we got some...
got a few cool things.
There's a lot of things that will kill us.
Yeah.
So Nyx, what do your character want to do while I'm voting on the nastiest thing on this poll?
Okay. You'd never do that to us, though, would you? Be honest. Okay, I've killed the goblin. I noticed the huge fucking bird, so...
Little help, if you would.
Yes, indeed.
He wants to nibble on my giblets.
Is that
he
all?
Wants to jibble on so my lucky. Niblets.
I'm just going to dash over there. Dash will get me there. I'll do 2 strength Texas. Yes, that. Okay, does a 14 and then that 20 actually get me over into the pit and then back up the other side?
There it is.
It does, but you don't have any actions left.
I know I don't. But I'm there to do something next round, because that's all I can do.
Yeah, so top of the round, Strathic.
Okay, this thing is like reduced movement speed, so it's not coming at me. But I'm going to take a step back and I'm going to do another Ray of Frost. Because
any advantage?
Yes.
There's a large target.
Large target indeed.
That doesn't count as a large target. I don't know what
so
does.
19 for 4 cold damage.
Yeah. So you basically blast this ray of frost, and you can hear it squawking out in pain as the ray of frost blasts off it, but it's still coming at the guys. So Scarlet, now it's down to you. Live or die.
Oh, I don't like this.
All right, life or death, folks.
Nat 20.
It's not gonna happen. I'm not getting a nat 20.
Nat 20, come on.
As long as I at least get a 10.
Come on. Yes. Okay. 13.
We aren't down yet. We aren't down yet.
Oh, just got to do it another two times, that's all.
Yay.
Oh boy. Oh, by the way, David, you might want to look at a straw poll there to see.
You might want to look at that result.
Is voting done?
It looks like
pretty much.
We
had a heck of a lot of votes come through.
All right, well, hang on. What happened? I never vote on these because I don't want to influence things.
Oh, I do.
Hang on, let me see. Oh.
Right.
I'm happy about this. I'm happy that this is winning. This is nice.
So we'll let Nyx go first and then we'll do that. So Nyx, do you want to go?
Oh my god.
I am going
Let's do it first because it may influence what you decide to do.
Oh, I'm fine. Come on.
So basically, Nyx, as you're kind of debating what to do, you kind of see this dark, inky sort of black matter detach itself from the wall and form up into like a small gnomish like character. It's like a dark-skinned gnome covered in tattoos and like jewelry hanging from his nose and stuff. Now, in you know how in 300 the kind of master people that have like they're bald and they've got all the jewelry hanging off and sort of thing. Looks a bit like one of them, sort of like the masters from 300, like a gnomish version. And he kind of leans closer to Scarlet's character, and he opens his mouth and he blows, and this white vapor sort of slips out of his mouth basically and covers Scarlet's character. And then a few seconds later, Scarlet's character's gone.
No! Not gone!
Oh, this is a little different.
Not gone, don't do this!
This is
GM license, yeah.
Come on! Oh, that's mean!
I tried so hard. Everyone wanted me.
And Scarlet, your character's sitting in a salon, in like a Wild West salon, sort of saloon, sorry. But it's obviously
it's a beauty salon.
His sort of bandit sort of class is a little bit like a Wild West class almost. So you're sitting in this Wild West saloon from where your character was actually from before you were kidnapped. And you remember this place, and there's a piano in the corner, and there's a guy playing on the piano, and there's a bartender at the bar.
and
you're actually playing poker, and you're playing poker with a gnome.
Okay.
And you're sitting there with a royal flush in your hand, and the gnome pushes all his chips towards you, basically, and puts down his cards, and he's not quite beat you. You put your cards down, basically. And then you reappear in this wisp of smoke at the back behind the griffin on full health and roll a wild magic surge.
Oh,
nice.
So really quick, how much do I need to roll for the wild magic? Is it 10,000?
10,000.
Oh boy, it's our DTK, a table of madness.
6, 5, 2, 4.
Right, oh, better than mine, just set to find the table.
Yeah, I'm going to change that command to wild magic.
Let's go and know about this one for once.
So what was the number, sorry?
6, 5, 2, 4.
6, 5, 2, 4. And if anyone wants to see this table, it is available below the chat.
I'm not looking.
Chat,
then. Okay.
Re-roll that one because it doesn't really make sense.
Fair enough.
It's basically red target reacts violently to anyone who attacks the caster.
Yeah, I'm not a caster, so.
No.
8355.
Oh, that's higher.
Oh my god.
I'm just gonna keep getting you re-rolling until the star falls. So is that 8355?
8355.
Oh, and thanks so much to the Crimson Phoenix. He donates £10 and says, last donation of the day. Alex, you're not getting out of this yet. Roll at D10,000, Wild Magic Surge, 2 more times. Also, Kalima.
Oh, come on.
I don't even know what the first one is yet.
Right, so the first one is all members of a major race are rendered sterile.
Oh.
Now, given we're in a world
in a world where everyone is sterile.
Well, anyway, because you've only just come back from your normal world, everyone of your race in your normal world has somehow been made sterile.
No!
As the price for saving your life.
Oh,
it's so mean.
Oh, that's horrible.
Oh. And I think, was that another two?
Another two more.
I gotta roll another one. Here we go.
Another two more.
5, 7, 4, 9.
And roll again. You got to roll two more.
Yeah. Well, let's still listen to one at a time first. So
No, this is the one.
That was the second one.
No, you got to roll three altogether.
Slow down, guys. 5, 7.
5, 7, 4, 9.
You know, today's another £10. It's three altogether, mate.
Lord Kalimar. Kalimar, motherfucker.
Oh, no, it's not even the DM laughs.
What? Target gains a level.
Hey!
Oh, no! Oh, that's not fair.
Right, however, let me read the full sentence out. Target gains a level, but one of his arms turns to steam forever.
I can transplant that. I can fix it.
You gain a level, but one of your arms vanishes.
Great.
This is going to be fun.
Level 4 now, so I'm going to...
Now, actually... roll a d6 on a 1 or 2. It's your dominant arm.
Ooh. Oh, thank God. Okay.
Right, and now we've got one last wild magic roll, and then
we do that one, let me do my stats real quick.
The sterile level.
Oh, no.
And you're human, right?
I'm human.
Yeah, so all humans are now sterile.
Oh, jeez.
Oh, no.
All right, let's roll the final wild magic. 71.
Ooh.
Is that all? Damn.
That's all.
That's a pretty low one.
71.
I think that's probably one of the lowest ones we've had.
Yeah,
I think so, yeah.
Now, it says after each spell, but I'm going to do this after each attack because you're not a spellcaster.
Okay.
But after each spellcaster feels overwhelmingly dizzy. So after each attack, your character feels overwhelmingly dizzy and suffers disadvantage on any reactions, we will say. So I'm not going to have it affect your next action because I think that would be a bit unfair. But I will say that because you're dizzy, you suffer disadvantage to any reactions that you may take.
Okay, so you suffer from bouts of dizziness. You've made your entire race sterile.
And one of my arms has turned to steam.
There we go.
And you're still getting attacked by the griffin. So let's finish this griffin off in the next couple of minutes, and we'll call it there for today.
Perfect. Sure.
Do I get to attack since now I'm back here?
Yes, but you can only attack with one of your crossbows because one of your hands has turned to smoke.
Yeah. You can't wield your crossbows anymore!
However, because you are now one level... Oh no, it depends whether it affects your proficiency bonus or not. You're level 4 now, so I'm not sure if that's going to affect your proficiency bonus or not, or whether you've upped your stats, it might, but yeah, go ahead.
I already upped my stats. It's not affecting anything.
Sterile loss of arm.
Because I'm not dual wielding, my armor class does drop a little bit.
Right, fine. So roll to hit the griffin.
17.
That is a perfect number.
4 points of piercing damage. You do 4 points of damage to the griffin.
Nice.
Next up, we have Nyx. Your go.
Wait, yeah. Hang on.
Yep.
Hang on.
I may not be able to dual wield the crossbows, but would I be able to very quickly, like, drop it and swipe at it with the sword that I have? Because I do still have extra attack.
That works for them.
I thought you don't get extra attack to level 5.
Wait, did I get that earlier or not?
You should get a level 5 usually if you're a...
No, it's only with the crossbows. Never mind.
Yeah. So, I assume it's something class specific for you.
It is, yeah.
Normally you don't get it to level 5.
Yeah. If I'm dual wielding the crossbows, then I can do an extra attack with the other crossbow.
No, because the other crossbow dropped and fired off when it dropped. Because obviously your hand turned to steam, the crossbow dropped, the mechanism fired, and it's now unreloaded.
Yeah.
Which is actually an interesting point, how you're going to reload your crossbow with one arm.
Mm.
But we'll worry about that next session. Let's continue. Nick, you'll go.
Awesome. Great axe attack.
A lot's happened in that 6 seconds, Nick.
Yeah.
Have I seen any of it, though?
No, but, you know...
It's been a blinding rain.
A couple of billion humans cried out in pain, but that was in a different world.
Yeah, but I didn't see them, so...
cried out in sterility.
20, 23 to hit.
That's a hit.
5 slashing damage.
You basically, you leap forward and you bring this axe down over the griffin and its head rolls across the floor in front of you. And we will
close
today's session there, folks. Thank you very much to chat for making this a very enjoyable session.
Yeah,
definitely.
Yeah, no kidding.
Yeah, that was a great one. Thank you, guys. So we are wrapping up this game here, but do not fear, because I'm going to be back in a few moments' time for the Lost Mine of Phandelver game. Myself, Charlie, Josh, and Kira's going to be there. Beth won't be there tonight. But we're going to be playing teaching you guys how to play D&D whilst going through that standard module. So stick around, don't go anywhere. We're going to take a few moments here just to wrap up and say thank you to everyone who got involved in today's show. And first of all, we'll start with David. So thanks, David, for running this game. Any kind of hooks and plugs you want to throw out here at the end?
Nothing in particular. You can find me on Twitter at XPOverrated, as someone I'm sure has typed in the chat. Other than that, we will be, as I mentioned, we will be finishing off this session, this kind of campaign, it's been quite a small one, next week. So tune in next week to find out what happens to the remaining characters that are alive still.
Oh, yeah.
See how much more Skag's character, Nick's character, will eat. And then obviously, yeah, guys, do stay tuned for the next session afterwards. It'll be well worth your time.
Yeah, awesome stuff. Perfect. So, Rach, thoughts on today's session? Any hooks and plugs?
No hooks and plugs this time, but I have to say I absolutely loved this session. And I think as far as XP's evilness has gone, he's reached a new high, so...
It's just mild. Wait till you see the next time.
Yeah, you just made me eat parts of Skag that I'd rather I hadn't eaten. I mean...
You chose to. I believe your exact words at the time was, my character probably doesn't mind.
I said my character doesn't know.
Same difference, eh? Well,
it's not the same difference.
Anyway, Scarlett, thoughts on the session? Hooks and plugs?
This is the first time that I've come back from the dead, yeah. So that's nice.
Lost an arm?
Yeah, got a fancy mist arm now, which in my head I'm envisioning it as like I can still move and function the arm, but it's just misty, so it can't grip anything, and it's just kind of there.
Yeah.
Yeah, let's work that one out in chat before next week.
So that's all fun and good. Thank you to everyone that didn't let me die.
Oh man!
But
perfect
as for plugs, yeah. I got nothing.
All
next
right,
week though, I will have something.
Okay, perfect. Well, stay tuned for that then. Let's go on to our countdown for the next show. Like I say, guys, don't go anywhere. I'll be back in 10 minutes with Lost Mine of Phandelver. Thanks for watching, tuning in. Thanks to everyone who donated throughout today's session and who followed along. We'll see you guys in but a few moments. Until next time, try not to roll too many net ones, because we want to be here laughing when...